of these cold open things where everybody just talks. I think they're terrible. Complete waste of time.
No, I've only seen a cold open work once, and that was Letterkenny.
That's right. I know, just what a waste of time, yeah.
No, I like intros.
Right, well, in that case, we'll do an intro. How do you like them apples?
Rock and roll!
Yeah!
That's a good start, I thought. You know?
Pick some choice bands for that.
Absolutely.
Yeah, took me a while
I had to wear the hair down for this one today. Yeah, man.
Yeah, I wish I could. I've got my Brian May wig up the back here. I could put that on, I guess. But it's been done. That joke's been done. Well, good afternoon, good evening, good day, everybody. Here we are again for some metal mayhem and madness with my rock hard panel. They're forged in steel and, well, a little bit of aluminium thrown in around the edges. But first of all, before we go any further, I would like to just say a quick hello to everybody in the chat who's already here. And I do appreciate that as usual. So we have our very good friend, Cosmic Squirrel. Man of many faces or many names, good buddy of ours. We have some guy called Joe's Atmosphere. He keeps bugging us in the chat. I don't know who he is. But...
I like playing with the chat, man.
I know. Darius Munchausen. We have Nosferatu the Vampire, who's always welcome. D. Bud Martin, good to see you, my friend. And Zax is already here. Hopefully more will be streaming in as we explore the depths, the heights of metal, the loudest, the fastest, the silliest, the best albums, the worst albums, the most metal looking, the most offensive bands, and anything else that comes into our mind. It's all up for grabs. We will have our opinions. People in the chat will have their opinions, and I'm definitely looking forward to hearing those in each of the categories. What I would like to do first is, before I introduce my panel, is ask them all a question about that montage. Now, I uploaded that as a test privately to YouTube, and only one of those clips spurred a copyright claim. Who can guess which one it was?
Metallica.
That's what I was going to say.
I'm going to be the dissenting opinion here and go with Anthrax.
Darius, what do you think?
No, I don't think it would be Metallica. Whichever one is the most popular?
Well, that's a subjective.
Right.
It wouldn't be any of the Norwegian bands. I think Metallica settled their whole thing with Napster. And I don't have the heart to say Judas Priest.
That would suck.
Well, I know it's Courtney who is coming on the panel later. She's a little, she has something to do right
crazy
now.
Train.
She says, Crazy Train. We've had
I'll
a couple of Metallicas. I must award today's prize, which is the satisfaction of knowing as a smart arse, to Pope Metallicus, who said Anthrax.
Wow.
Really?
The only copyright claim on that montage.
Anthrax's label is famous for being absolute Nazis.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, that's Island Records, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I could not be bothered to cut it out. And it's only a claim. It's not a strike or anything. So, you know. And I'll just add, before I introduce everybody, I'll add another special guest to the
Makes
stream.
Makes me wonder if that song was a cover.
Hey, Paul.
Mr. Paul.
Hey, Chito. Paul.
Huh. How Welcome. Are you, sir?
You don't mind me inserting myself into this?
Not at all, sir. You're a little quiet on the volume, but no, you're welcome to join, and I do appreciate it.
We're big fans of insertion.
There we go. How's that?
There'll be a lot of insertion in this stream today, I would imagine. Thrusting.
That is much better, my friend.
And how's your holiday?
Well, I've been gone for a month, and I forgot how to use a mic.
I saw your pictures of you RVing across Canada. Very, very nice, sir. Good job.
Yeah, we had a great time. Sorry to interrupt.
Oh, no, 70s.
Thanks for joining. So to get round to introducing the panel to everybody, as if they didn't know who you all are, I have, first of all, my awfully good friend, the co-executive semi-assistant producer of the show.
Swelling from here.
That would be, something is definitely swelling from here. That would be Mr. Darius Munchausen.
That's popcorn.
Buttered popcorn.
Popcorn chicken, come on!
Welcome, Darius. How are you?
Yeah, doing good today. I'm actually having a pretty good day. Had a good weekend.
Oh,
nice to hear, my friend. Nice to hear. And I'm assuming you have the levers of power behind the scenes here, too, if I need any help. You can cut people out of the stream.
Yep.
There you go. You can drop people out of the stream if I give you the nod. You can mute them, all that good stuff. Thank you.
I could drop you out, but I wouldn't.
You could, and then I'll go and off have a couple of beers and let you guys just carry on. But hang on, the show. There we go. Just checking. Next, of course, is our another one of our great regulars, the wonderful Imperator. I will be doing a more appropriate one for you soon, but that's all you get today.
Well, you know, it is what it is. I mean, I did give you my theme song, so.
You did, and I haven't had the chance to cut it yet. I haven't clipped it yet, so.
Yeah, that one you got to be careful how you clip, because there's a few lines in there that might get just struck just as soon as you play my intro.
Exactly. So I've got to be careful with that one. Not that I can make out a word they're saying anyway, but. So you're our resident expert on death, black, bludgeoning metal. So
yeah, that's one way to put it.
Yeah, you're going to be contributing heavily to the backstory in a lot of these bands that we have categorized today. So I'm looking forward.
I wouldn't say a lot, but a good chunk of them. Yeah.
Cool. Underneath you, as is his wont, is are also our good friend and permanent panelist on the show, Mr. Pope Metallicus the First. Possibly the most masculine man on the panel, I would say.
If we're just going by length, I mean, you know, I don't like to brag. thanks for having me on.
No, no problem, sir. Again, you've introduced me to some excellent bands recently, I have to say, like Sabaton. They're becoming one of my favorites.
You actually just did a stream on those guys yesterday.
Yeah, and I wish I wasn't at work and I would have joined you, but... moving on. Well, thank you for joining. Moving on, we have the wonderful, our friend Joe from Nolans. Joe's Atmosphere, and I think I even managed a clip for you, Joe. I want an atmosphere. I love a party with a happy atmosphere.
That works. Yeah, that works.
It's the most metal clip you'll see today.
It's always good to be known as the guy that listens to 70s pop on a metal show. Yeah, I'm going to get punked the whole show now. I can see it. Yeah. No, it's good to see you guys. Thanks for having me, man. I always enjoy being with you there, 70s. It's a lot of fun, always.
It's great to have you, my friend. Great to have you on. And another special guest, a man who's been on the channel a few times, and we're always extremely grateful that he is, Mr. Paul Chato.
Hello.
How are you? I have a clip for you, Paul, and it's disappeared.
You did?
I did, wow. And it's disappeared, so you're going to have to settle for this one, I think. You sound like a cop to me. Good old-fashioned masculine abuse.
Yeah.
Keep that hand strong, Jill.
Take that, yeah. And how are you, sir? Are you back in the swing of it yet after your trip?
I think so. It was a wonderful, wonderful time. I mean, taking an RV across the country has got two benefits. One, you have a slow climb into the vacation and a very slow denouement out of it, as opposed to getting on the plane, getting off the plane, getting back on the plane, getting home. That's gone.
Usually not getting on the plane now is the issue at the airport.
But, your permanent vacation is, you know, lining up. And then
did you actually end up in, you started in the far west and ended in the far east. Is that true?
Ended up in the far east. We're kind of in the middle-ish east in Ontario here, but we went all the way to the ends of Alberta and then up to northern Alberta and then made our way down. And it's quite far up there. People don't realize just how far things are.
Like Cold Lake and places like that, or
pretty close.
Very nice, good for you, sir.
It was good. And so now I'm back. I'm actually it's probably, of any vacation I've ever had, it's been the most easy to have gotten back into the saddle. Actually, I've never really
good. Well, I noticed you did have a new video earlier, which I'll be checking out.
Just came out. I went, oh, I got an idea. I'm writing it down and I'm doing it. So it just sort of came out.
Good like stuff. Good. Well, thank you for joining us here. I'm looking forward to
I'm going to be here just for a little bit, but no, I wanted to join you gentlemen, and wonderful to see you all.
Yeah, thanks, man. I always appreciate having you on, and I do appreciate your perspective on Norwegian death metal, particularly.
Finnish more,
I would say.
Finnish death metal. I don't know. I know more about Finnish death metal.
The real hardcore, in other words. Right. So before we get into the metal, I know this is absolutely not metal in the slightest, but I did want to just briefly comment on the sad death of Olivia Newton-John.
Bummer.
Bummer. I've always loved Grease. I know it's not everybody's cup of tea, but I've always thought it was a fabulous movie, and she was wonderful in it. Very lovely lady, from what I know about her. She's been suffering from issues with cancer since 1992 and gone through all sorts of things. So I hope she's free from pain now and resting in peace. And thank you, Olivia, for all the great stuff.
Grease. She was big in the 70s, and she had a breakout album with Physical and made that Grease movie. She did a movie called Xanadu. She was all
working
over the place.
ELO, I do love the ELO material.
Yeah, it's great stuff.
Yeah, so and she was once married for many years to Bruce Welsh of the Shadows, famous British instrumental group of the 50s, 60s, and 70s. So a little bit of a connection to the British pop scene of old. But anyway, RIP Olivia, and thanks for all the tunes. But yeah, so let's go on to metal. And I must mention to everybody in the chat, I'll be manipulating tons of images and video clips here today, and things will probably go badly wrong at points, but bear with me. Unless my executive producer helps me at various places. So I thought, as a fun thing to do, we could just kind of kick off with some categories for fun, say who we think are in those categories, and the chat too can give their thing, and we just debate about that. And it's a good way to lead into it, because we're really covering the entirety of metal today, from right from the beginnings to the present day, and lots of different genres. So we'll have some fun with that. And I really wanted to start with the category which has been for many years, people have debated even the merits of having such a category, which is the loudest metal band, or the loudest band, but let's say metal band in history. There are other bands have attempted to get into this category. So let me just share this. So we have some categories proposed by the panel, and obviously everybody in the chat can throw those in. And we have Testament, who are not necessarily a band I know that much about. But we also have three kind of slightly older bands. Well, Manowar, Motorhead, and AC/DC. Now, the loudest band thing, they actually had a Guinness Book of World Records for it, and it was measured so many feet from the stage in a crowd. And I think they may have stopped doing it because too many people were dying of brain trauma. And in fact, 136 decibels at 50 or 100 feet is actually the threshold of pain. It's like standing next to a jet engine when a plane's taken off.
The decibel level our Jewish Hungarian household was at all the time.
Yes, everyone was talking at that level. In fact, if a very loud person stands 1 inch from you and screams, that's the same level. So there you go.
Yeah, there you go. So it never went down below that. What are you talking about, Leslie?
Yeah, so for many years, Deep Purple were once a record holder in this category for live performance. The Who then were record holders.
I heard The Who were big.
Yeah, and then Manowar, in I think 1984, took the record with 129.5 decibels. Now, we're talking live music here. There is another strand of thought that says you can actually check the engineering on a CD to see which one is actually the loudest, has been recorded the loudest. I'm not quite sure how effective that is. I think live performance is really where it's at. And despite one or two other bands trying to take the throne, including the Risible Kiss at one point, Manowar still appear to hold the record for being the loudest band. So
I'd think AC/DC might have a chance at it if they did the test during the cannons firing. You know what I mean?
That's cheating. Yeah. Well, you could count the cannon as an instrument. Is it head cannon or just?
Yeah, I mean, it is percussion, so
that's true. Yeah. And it was in time.
Yes, it was.
So I'll move on from this. As I say, you've got an amateur producer here. There you go. So Motorhead have toyed with this this record at various points. I know that some of their gigs in like Hammersmith Odeon were measured pretty loud. And pretty fast too, of course. So they've got a good claim to it, I would say. Obviously, we have a very small picture of AC/DC with Bon Scott in 79. They were certainly getting up to brain aneurysm inducing levels. In fact, I think maybe slightly later in the Brian Johnson era, they did a big open air gig in Sydney, and people like 10 miles away were complaining about the noise. So,
wow. I think this needs to be qualified, this yes. record. And that is, I've been on stage with many bands. It's pretty quiet on stage.
Yeah.
It's the bands that are listening to it at the same level as the audience that should count.
Yes, and I think one or two bands like
Motorhead,
Manowar and Motorhead did have the stack behind them as
Correct.
Grateful Dead.
Yeah,
with their giant wall of sound.
That was to keep them awake.
I think that's pretty important, because I've been on stage and it's nice and
nice and calm,
nice and calm behind that giant wall of speakers pointing out to the audience.
Yeah, well, a lot of the backstage backline stuff is fake.
For sure.
They put the dummy marshals up and whatever.
I'm just saying that if the band isn't in pain, does it count?
That's right. Yeah, they must suffer for their art.
Correct.
There's certainly been at least one gig, I think, where three people passed out. I can't remember which one it was. One of these bands, people were passing out.
I think that one was Motorhead.
Was that Motorhead? Yeah.
I think it was Captain and Tennille.
Captain and Tennille. That's right. Yes. Captain's electric piano work was
the Rhodes. The Rhodes. He had that Rhodes just pumping.
That Fender Rhodes. Yeah. But Motorhead did have the reputation as the loudest band on earth. I've seen them, and I can testify it was pretty loud. That was back in the Ace of Spades era. Seen AC/DC a couple of times, also pretty loud. I can't say it was deafeningly loud, though, AC/DC, when I saw them. However, another band that has a reputation for going there, well, that's Man of War, but is Testament. Yeah, Testament of a reputation.
This is the only band I've ever worn earplugs for.
Yeah, they were pretty fucking loud. I didn't know that going in, so I didn't bring any, but oops.
Yeah, but then again, I have also seen them more in a small venue setting and not like an arena. So
yeah, that's where I saw them too. It was like a 1,500, 2,000 person arena. Or not arena, but venue.
So what would you guys say is the loudest band you've ever seen live, all of you?
Seen live? Testament.
Yeah, either Testament or Cannibal Corpse, as far as loudness.
I would probably have to also say Testament.
For me, it'd be Van Halen, because most of the metal bands that I saw was in nightclubs when I was a bartender. I didn't really see too many big concert metal bands. I guess the closest things to metal that I saw was like ZZ Top, Van Halen, and Kiss. That's about the closest I came to seeing a true metal band live in a big venue. So I'd have to say, it was them. Yep.
Kiss were pretty loud. I mean, I'm not a big Kiss fan, which is why I try not to talk about them much, but they did do a gig in Canada in Ottawa where it measured 136 decibels, and they eventually were forced to turn the volume down due to complaints.
Now, they did have a lot of explosives the night I saw them. I saw them on their last mass tour.
Yeah.
Eric Carr, he had Fox makeup, had already taken over the drums, but it was the original bunch. And their set was a tank. And during his solo, he would do a drum roll and it would move the tank, and he pointed at the speakers above the stage and they blew them out with explosives and stuff. It was pretty cool looking. That was kind of loud. It might be Kiss, but I think it was Van Halen was probably the loudest one I saw.
Yeah. Funnily enough, for me, it wasn't any of them. I've seen numerous metal bands, and some of them, like the Wild Hearts, were intensely loud, but that was in clubs. The loudest band I ever saw was an Irish punk band called Stiff Little Fingers. And it was
nice to be your nickname.
Great name.
It was so loud.
Was that Gary's old band?
It was probably. It was so loud I actually had to leave the concert hall for a while because it was giving me an intense headache.
Yeah, the loudest band I ever saw in a nightclub was Five Finger Death Punch. That was crazy. It was loud. I had to shove some napkins in my ears that night. That was crazy.
We'll be seeing these lovely, gorgeous guys in a few of these categories, Man of War.
Although I would say Amon Amarth is up there in terms of volume. I saw them with Slayer, and they really crank out the noise.
Yeah, and you got to wonder, is noise in its own right a good thing?
Mm-hmm. Can be.
Not necessarily, no.
I think you're right that the venue does make a difference, because I've seen Testament, Motorhead, and Van Halen all up at Pine Knob, which is a huge outdoor arena. They're all extremely loud, but it was never as painful as Harpo's.
Yeah.
You know, which is a smaller venue, and they really crank it up there.
Yeah, I've typically erred on the side of the louder the better, so that's why I'm partially deaf now.
Well, they can things can get distorted. I mean, you know, the here in Shreveport, I'm in the northern part of Louisiana, and they have a venue called the Hirsch Coliseum. And the one little piece of trivia that I learned over the years was ZZ Top always started their tours here, and they're from next door in Texas, right? But they always started them here, and they figured if they could get the sound right at the Hirsch, they could get it right anywhere because of how bad it was. So, you know, that's why they always came here. It was crazy.
So I'm going to attempt, at the risk of us getting shut down, playing a couple of little clips from these bands. So, and I don't know if you can hear this.
Nope.
No.
Nope. No hearing.
Nope.
Let me reshare it. So I will say that
version is my favorite version of Overkill.
Oh, that's mine too, that live version from that
they absolutely gig. Slayed that.
I'm going to try this again, so forgive me if that... Now, you should be able to hear it this time. Okay.
Yep.
So that's Motorhead's claim. That is my favorite version of this too.
It's good stuff.
So that's their claim to fame in this category, I would say. As I say, we might get shut down for me doing this, but I'm going to give it a try. It's tough to talk about music without playing music, you know. Well, let's have a little bit of...
Nah, you'll get shut down.
Whole lot of Rosie. 79, so...
Angus!
Classic AC/DC.
Bon Scott, baby.
I just love this era. That's when I really got into them. 77, 78, 79. And I would love to... I didn't see them till Back in Black tour, so I would love to have seen them in this era.
I believe he wasn't in Black and Back in Black. He was.
That's what he's saying.
Well,
he
I would love to have seen the Bon Scott era, you know, live. But I believe they were formidable. Let's put it that way.
Do you want me to let in the guest?
Friend, you got it. Courtney. We have a friend, Courtney, here.
Welcome, Courtney.
Hello.
Can you hear me now?
I can hear you now. Okay. If you'll take away the biggest part of me. I got to introduce you, you know. I'm pretty sure I've got a piece of music to introduce you. Okay. What happened to it? I've lost it. Never mind.
You'll have to do with it.
It was Looks That Kill.
Yeah, you played it last time.
Oh, wait.
Yeah.
So that's Courtney.
There we go.
So AC/DC, there's a little bit of their claim to fame of the loudest.
I think it's true, though. Venues count.
They do.
Because, just the fact that you can be in front of the stage and not right in front of the stack will make a huge difference in terms of your enjoyment of the band.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
And those wing stacks.
If you're watching an exceptionally loud band, but you're 3/4 of a mile from the stage or the stack.
Well, there's that too. I mean, I saw a lot of Canada's top punk bands because I was into that era. The Vile Tones were extremely loud.
Yeah.
But they were not huge venues. They were, 500 seat places.
You just reminded me of who it was that died today, other than Olivia Newton-John. It was the guy from Teenage Head.
Oh, really?
What?
Jeff, I can't remember his name.
Oh, no.
Teenage Head, one of those guys died, and there's some talk that it's a bit weird, you know?
Oh.
I'm sorry that I
foul play afoot?
Foul play afoot, yes.
Hashtag Clinton body count.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. So that's who it was. Thank you for reminding me, Paul. It was a teenage Head member that died.
Yeah, Teenage Head. I saw them live. They were not louder than the Vile Tones, though.
We talked about them last time, Paul.
Ah,
Teenage Head. Ain't That No Sense. I love that song.
It's a great, album. Great band.
Yeah, that's a shame.
So it's a shame, yeah. I'll have to look up more about what happened later. But so Testament were another of our categories of super loud guys. You know, it's kicking up a bit of a storm.
Yeah, it's Wall of Sound.
And yeah, some of you guys have seen them live, which is the ultimate test.
Not only are they loud live, but they're incredibly just good live.
Yeah, their sound is very, very clean live, even though they play it at extreme volumes, which is awesome.
Yeah, and the last on our little list of loudest was Manowar.
This could get you struck.
If I keep it low,
they're just a bunch of unmitigated douchebags.
Don't do it. Take it off.
Yeah, stop it.
There's a reason Razor Fist hasn't done a metal mythos for them.
That's probably enough to get us killed. I don't mind getting claimed. I just don't want to get the stream stopped. So what do the people in the chat think? I have to just get back to that. So we have
a Queen in there.
Is it Queen? Queen. I've seen Queen, and they were very loud, but also very. It wasn't so loud that you couldn't hear every nuance of it, you know, which was, right. was good. Mm-hmm. Obviously,
Sabbath, that was my point earlier. Some of it can get loud to the point of distortion. Whenever I went to see a show, I always stood in the back by the engineering booth, on the floor, but back there where the engineering booth was, because I figured if they got it right, then it was going to sound good right next to them. You know what I mean?
I have to say Genesis had a pretty loud sound, to be quite honest. I had to put earplugs in for Genesis.
Yeah, and it doesn't have to be a metal band, of course. No. Yeah, there's bands like
which Left era? Field. Peter Gabriel or
Peter Phil Gabriel? Collins? Oh yeah, Lamb Lies Down.
Yeah,
a lot of electronic bands have got a reputation for being pretty loud, like Left Field. Punk bands obviously are all trying to be as loud as they can. So it's not metal specific, but this is a metal show, so we'll. But yeah, that's I think from what I've heard from you guys, Testament may well be the winner of this category today.
Manowar is probably louder. I just haven't seen them live because they never toured the States.
I never have. No. But they'll be seeing more of them later because they fall into one or two categories. And our good friend Christian Delorme is here. Good to see you, buddy. Lord Thoth, the Range Mensch. Darius, apparently there's a guy called Darius in the chat, and he seems to have seen all of these bands at the same place. Was that Woodstock 99?
No. And Van Halen was at a later time, but I've seen them all at Pine Knob. Testament and Motorhead.
Oh, I've been to Pine Knob.
Yeah. Metal Masters in 2008, and then I saw Van Halen in 2015.
Yeah, I've seen Kid Rock at Pine Knob. That's probably going to turn a lot of people off, but
no, he does a great show.
I took my kid to see Kid Rock when she was 15 as her birthday present, and I thought he was just a glorified DJ. I really didn't know that much about him at the time. This shows. Is 16 years ago, and when they did this, when he did the solo part where he plays every instrument on the stage, I was blown away. Right. I was like, wow,
right?
This is amazing.
He does
this guy's
a great
talented.
Show, yeah, brilliant yeah. show.
I saw him at Comerica Park, and he had a kid come up on the stage with him and play the drums.
Wow.
Yeah. He's like, just play like this, and then he played with the kid.
He does like that section where he goes around and plays every instrument himself and mm-hmm. does the mixing. And the...
But yeah, while lighting a cigar and pouring himself a glass of whiskey.
It's a lot of fun, yeah.
I'm not going to comment on that because I would be the one to give you a crap about Kid Rock. So.
I know you would. That's why I said
I commented
some people
semi.
Might.
I won't go
some people
up.
Might not be so keen, but but as a right. live act, he was brilliant. Yeah, Queen would have been loud, especially back in the day when you'd see them in theaters. So
I love that you say stiff little fingers, by the way, for your.
Oh
loudest.
Yeah, that was the loudest gig I've ever been to. So loud it hurt. I think I lost all my fillings that night.
Courtney, Soul Assassin says you're not down with the Bob with the Ba.
No.
The Ba,
the Ba. The Bang, the Biggie, whatever it is.
So it's going,
hey, I wasn't saying the guy is, you know, an epic lyricist or anything. I was just, you know.
Gord Lewis is the guy.
Caught off guard by how talented he was. Yeah.
I don't know, Courtney. If I can get dragged to an ICP show, I think you can suffer through Kid Rock.
ICP. Oh my God. That was the craziest band we ever had at a place called Malibu Alley behind one of the nightclubs I worked at. We had an alley that we had concerts in. It was like a Kiss concert. Everybody came to that thing with face makeup on. It was crazy.
Yeah. Welcome to the Juggalos. We don't interact with them. Yeah. They're very strange people. Yes.
So
I never saw them live, but I dealt with their fans, and in the same type of situation, they were playing at a club on the same street in Boston. I swear, a kid was probably 12 years old, and he smacked my ass. But
that does not surprise me.
I looked at this kid like, "Who are you, and why are you wearing that dumb?"
The disaster area says Sabbath closed the Commonwealth Games today. I hope that was the opening ceremony. That would have been great if they closed it. Like, no games, just, you know, Sabbath gig, it's over.
Well, that, I thought they were done as a band.
It's the Commonwealth Games. That's a big thing if you're ruled by the Queen, you know. So probably they came out of final retirement to do that. I wonder what they played. They've played for the Queen before, of course. But,
yeah, Seven Dust was pretty loud. We had them at the Malibu Beach Club. I remember that. Yeah.
And we'll be talking about Dragon Force later again. So they're on their way. So that's the loudest. And unless anyone's got any other comments about loud.
Yeah, I didn't really get to comment on loud.
Well, hey, comment away, my dear.
But I have to think. I'm Gwar. Gwar was really odd, but it was because of where I saw them play. It was a smaller smaller place for them to play, but Gwar was very loud. And Slayer. Yeah. I saw Slayer in Rhode Island at this smaller venue, and they
Slayer
were
is loud as hell.
Yeah, they were super loud.
Slayer's a band that could fit in lots of these categories, like loudest, fastest, but they're just immense. Yeah.
They're Slayer.
Sure. Oh, Brahma may be joining us soon, but good to see you, Brahma. Right, so I'm going to move on to the next category, if you guys are okay with that, which will be the fastest.
Slipknot, that's a good one, yeah. Mm-hmm.
The fastest band. Let me take the fair copyright notice off. See, my assistant co-producer is slacking here.
What?
Just messing with you, mate. There we go. So we had some suggestions before the show. Dragon Force being one of them. Nile, which I think are pretty fast. Marduk, we were mentioned in multiple categories here. And Napalm Death. But Napalm Death are on here for one song in particular, which I might even play now. So Napalm Death proved, I think, that they were the fastest band ever with this particular song. And that's it.
Amazing.
Truly. That's a grind. Where you show up half hour late to a grind band show and you missed the first five acts.
That's right. Right. I'll just do it one more time. That is it. Napalm Death, fastest band in the world.
That I can appreciate.
It was You Suffer.
You Suffer. Yeah, I was just going to say that. You Suffer.
But we didn't suffer because it was only 3 seconds long. So, you know.
Are we talking speed metal here? I don't know any of these bands.
This is death metal.
Nile's death metal, Marduk's black metal, and
Dragon Force is power metal.
Yeah, they're obnoxiously pretentious.
Oh yeah.
I think you could have had Slayer in here for sure. I mean, and hell, you could even have had
some Anthrax. Iron Maiden stuff, I would think.
Maiden, Anthrax.
Maiden's a lot slower paced than people think.
But, well, a couple of their songs, my brother and I used to call them mailed in music. Like all the band members were on four corners of the United States and they just tried out "Do Each Other" without listening to each other, and then slammed it all together. We called it mailed in music, you know.
But when you see like the tremolo picking that a band like Marduk or most black metal bands do, like it is absolutely stupid fast.
Yeah,
mm-hmm. It's like 240 beats per minute.
What about like Ministry? Would they count?
Oh, I love Ministry.
They
Ministry
got pretty fast there. With some of their.
It's true.
So
Darius.
I think a lot of these bands could easily have been in here, and you know, we're getting various suggestions in the chat, and please suggest away.
This is one of the things I wanted to talk about before I have to pop out, but I'm of the opinion that all this increase in speed killed classic rock and roll.
Darius is back. Didn't know he'd left. Hello, Darius again.
Yeah.
I think so. The emphasis in speed has, there's a point where you actually just have a wall of sound and you can't really hear anything.
And no more lead work, delicate lead work. Interesting.
That, I think, is what actually killed it. Like the more extreme stuff, like death and black metal was already popular in the 80s and moving into it, but they were still doing
pretty
complicated stuff with composition and lead breaks and stuff like that. I think it was where they were. They all downtuned and went into the new metal and industrial metal phase, and all of the old metalheads were just like, "This is no, go away."
Yeah, I think you know Uig or whatever his name is.
Nick's got a good point. Demolition Hammer would be up there with some of their stuff.
Yeah.
Anyway, I just thought I'd throw that out there that melodic rock died with the speeding up of metal.
Yeah, well, not everything faster is better. That's true. Nile, I think, might be the exception to that because they still manage to keep a lot of intricate work.
Well, Slipknot too.
There's a lot of power metal bands that are extremely fast that play that are still very melodic and do a lot of very complicated.
I agree, but it's
like
it's,
Blind Guardian and stuff like that.
Yeah, mm-hmm. But it's not Cream.
No, it's way better.
Oh!
Shots fired.
Oh, I love it.
Napalm Death.
Sorry, Eric.
Dragon Force.
Now, the thing is, I listened to Ministry in the 60s, and I thought they were great. Yeah. That was fast.
Wait.
Well, this is it. All these bands had inspirations from further back. There were fast bands. There were heavy bands. You know, loud bands like Vanilla Fudge. And then it led into Sabbath, probably the archetypal proto originators of metal, Black Sabbath, who had fast and heavy and loud. And they dressed like a metal band. Dragon Force, Nile, who I'm not necessarily totally familiar with. I've been listening to some of their stuff this week just to get into this. And then Marduk, who again can appear in multiple categories in this.
And we can't play anything they do on.
No, we can, just not certain songs.
Yeah, I think
they'd wash.
Well, it's a bit sweaty up there on stage, Paul.
Yeah, you're right.
Hey, at least he's not wearing a pentagram-shaped fuck harness on in this image, which this is better than their live act.
Actually, different singer, so that's probably...
That's right, yeah.
It's not me from singing.
I did have, and I'm just going to try and play a little bit of clips of these. So bear with me again, so we can hear a little bit of each band. I got to get the overlay on first, just in case. Sorry, wrong one. That one.
Let's see.
Not that it'll help, but you know. So let's see. We got fastest. Let's start with. We've had Napalm Death. All 3 seconds of it. A little bit of Nile, I think. Can you guys hear this?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we're going to use that for our wedding.
I was fixing to say
that. Right, yeah. I do like a good ballad, a good romantic ballad.
That voice changer is used as something else.
It is.
That's not a voice changer.
It's not? What is it?
That's his natural voice.
You're kidding me.
Natural voice.
No.
Wow.
I've never heard these
to get
guys.
Some intricate riffs in though.
Nile's weird because they just have a decidedly Egyptian bent.
They do get into stuff. The Egyptian stuff, and
yeah, they call their genre ithyphallic metal, which is
Greek quite into Lovecraft. Yeah, that's right, and they're into Lovecraft as well.
Does Buckethead count?
Buckethead would always count.
Okay. These guys are also good live.
They're from South Carolina. These guys, which I didn't know.
Yeah, a lot of death metal bands are from like the southeast of the U.S.
I've actually got one of their legit demos sitting in one of my closets.
Nice.
Oh, nice.
From back in the day.
So that was Nail. I think we'll have a look. No,
it's
I
always
think we can,
good to have a nice bootleg or two sitting around.
I think I can play this Marduk one, but I may be wrong.
Yeah, you're fine with this forward. One.
Yeah, this one's okay. All right. I looked through a few, and this one seemed fine. Frontschwein. Now, I don't know how many beats per minute this is, but that guy's definitely not playing that on that drum kit.
This is actually one of their slower tracks, too.
Yeah, this is downpaced for them.
Because when it gets to a certain point, it is just a wall of sound then.
Well, that's the whole point of tremolo picking that fast, is to kind of make it warble into a single note. Mm-hmm. And so you're doing like four repetitions of the same note in very rapid sequence.
But I've noticed a lot of bands that play in this style, the sort of black metal style, some of the more progressive ones will then have the very ethereal keyboards off the top of the top.
Yep.
Which is very interesting difference. You know, like the keyboards themselves are almost orchestral or light.
Yeah, Emperor does a good job with that. Limbonic Art does a good job with that. Ancient used to do a good job with that.
Yeah, and then I think we have one more in this category, which is Dragon Force. And again, I'll flip forward to what they're actually playing. And this is a more of a... I know they were good. I mean, they were prog, really. I guess you could say they were a prog band, more than metal. But they were lovely. Yeah,
I think they were the first popularish band that actually did dual lead.
That's right. Yeah, and then Thin Lizzy had a bit
of it. Yeah, I was just gonna
say. Yep. Say Priest were doing that in like '74, but
Thin Lizzy.
Thin Lizzy.
So that was the candidates for fastest. I'm just wondering if anyone in the chat, I'm scrolling through, has got any... well, Kitty Bear says he can understand the lyrics of that. I'm assuming he's talking to Dragon about Dragon Force, because that one's sung in normal voice.
Yeah. If you can understand the lyrics, it does.
Yeah. I'm looking for... Judas Priest were fast in their day, and they were. And Judas Priest are certainly in here in various categories.
And if you can understand the Marduk lyrics, I'm sorry, but you're going to hell.
Right,
that one was about, you know, being a frontline soldier.
Well, yeah, that's
what it translates to.
True, yeah.
Yeah, the so Paul can explain to us about Buckethead.
Well, what do you want to know about Buckethead? I mean, was a guitarist for hire, brilliant guitarist, played for several bands, including Guns N' Roses, and just didn't want to be part of corporate rock, and he just does. He cranks out albums like one a day.
Yeah. Self-published. Yeah.
Yeah. He's just a wonderfully eccentric guy with his own weird guitar. And, and he's older than people think. He's like 60 years old or something bizarre like that. And he's great. I love his stuff.
He's cool. Yeah.
He's a very cool dude and very kind to the audience. Just super, super nice and very fast. I think he might have been clocked as the fastest guitarist in the world.
Well, that's very possible. Yes, well, that one we'll have to park for a future show, the fastest guitarist in the world.
Yeah.
He's like a child guitar prodigy who just happens to be in his 50s now.
Yeah, okay, yeah.
50. Who is the best fret-melting plank spanker? So Darius, are you talking about Niall the band or about your love life, which is
Niall the band?
Niall,
I just heard the rest of my family show up. It means I gotta put some beef on the Barbie, so I have to say goodbye to everyone.
No, you gotta go, Matt. Hang on.
Hello, Paul.
Thanks for thanks for having me, and thanks for being had.
Really appreciate you dropping in, buddy. You're always welcome.
Absolutely. Oh, you've got a great show. I love the topic.
Thanks, man. And we'll get you back on next week. We're doing more music next week, and then we'll do Towering Inferno, the movie, the week after.
And I'm looking forward to the Debbie Boone episode. So
that will Debbie and Pat Boone, I think, will be
together. Bye. And he did some metal.
He did do a metal album. Yes.
Bye, everyone.
Cheers, Paul. Buddy. Take care, buddy.
Later, Paul.
It's good to meet you, Paul.
Yeah, he's a good guy.
Hey, 70s. I threw a chat into the private link that also falls into this category if you want to use it. It's the band, one of the bands Nick mentioned.
Yep.
Oh, right. So you want me to fire it up now?
Yeah, if you want.
Let me just put it in the right screen. Oh, Demolition Hammer. Yeah. Mike, can you
These guys are
this?
So underrated.
Oh, yeah.
I've seen their name mentioned many times.
They're my neck of the woods metal.
The thing about this is it's fast, but it's paced. It's not out of control.
Considering they're from New York City. I don't remember if it was Bronx or Brooklyn.
Yeah, it's still well under control.
Hope, weren't you guys talking about them just
recently? Yep, we did an episode on Demo Hammer, 2 weeks ago now?
Yeah. These guys are seriously underrated. They're thrashy. They have a little bit of death metal and a little bit of New York hardcore in there.
And I'm
I was
really
gonna
glad
say
that,
I've seen them play with a hardcore band.
And I am really glad that Imperatus and Nick bullied me into listening to them.
I don't listen to anything that sucks.
I absolutely love them.
Yeah, sounds good, mate. Yeah. More volume. These guys,
I mean, that right there is a sped up hardcore rift.
Yeah, yep. These guys wouldn't strike me. Oh, no, it's speeding up now.
I mean, how wrong can you go when you write a song about a volcanic explosion?
Yeah, right.
Oh, mention Demo Hammer and who shall appear?
Welcome back, my friends. Hang on, I gotta get rid of the current comment. There it is, Mr. Nick Visor.
Uh-oh.
Nick, buddy, you're looking so circular and numbery today.
Check him out.
How's it going, Nick?
It's funny how that happens. It's been a busy day over here at the household. It's been a very crazy week, but other than that, things are fine. I was listening as I was getting all food for the children set, and I was listening in, and I was hearing the whole stuff with the Nile and Dragon Force and Neapolitan Down. I'm like, man, you couldn't pick four different bands out of that. But anyways, I see we're talking about. I think we're talking about Demolition Hammer, and you know, that's an incredible band.
Fastest. What do you think about Loudest, though? I mean, what's your Loudest experience?
Loudest band. Oh boy. Let's see. I've been around 500 shows. I got to think about who do I define as the Loudest.
You mean you don't remember every one of them in detail?
No. I wish it was like that.
Yeah, if you remember the show, you didn't have enough fun.
Hail Southern Viking.
Yeah. I'm trying to think here. Oh man, there's a lot of them. Like, I mean, wow. Cannibal Corpse is very brutal live, and Obituary is very brutal live. Especially Obituary is interesting because they're not even that fast. They more go like a Black Sabbath type of tempo.
Yeah, they're definitely more mid-paced.
But with their vocals are what make it like really heavy because their vocalists has a very inhuman voice.
The guitar tone helps too.
Yeah, that guitar tone. Yeah, it's very, very muddy, very doomy-ish type
very
of guitar
chunky
tone that goes slightly faster. Like I say, it's like a steady heartbeat type of beat. But then, it's so heavy. Obituary is definitely one of them.
So would you ever say, though, Nick, you'd been to a gig where you said, you know what, this is too loud, I'm going to stand at the back?
Never.
Never.
Never. Oh yeah. I've been lucky. I've seen most of these bands. Like I see on this thing here. I see Dark Funeral back. I see In Flames with the old logo.
Mm-hmm.
I see Dismember. I was supposed to see Dismember, but they had US government issues that prevented them from playing. So maybe one day.
Yeah,
maybe one day. And then, of course, Slayer. I mean, when I first heard Slayer at the time, it was like Faster Than Lightning. it was absolutely crazy. But then all of a sudden you hear all the bands who got obsessed with Slayer, and then they created their own bands. You had, you know, Creator, Dark Angel, Sodom, Demolition Hammer, all the bands who got inspired by that fast sound. So they wanted to be like, how can we go even faster? So yeah, it's a great whirlwind of bands. But I'll shut up now so we can.
Parrothead thinks you were busy those days, though. Parrothead seems to think you're pretty normal.
I mean, if anything, some of those bands are servicing me.
In your ear hole.
Well, then it's not gay, then, is it? So we're moving on from faster, which we could have named a million bands in there, I'm sure, but
it depends on the venue on that category too, because open air is going to be a lot less loud than an indoor arena or a nightclub, you know. It has a lot to do with it.
And we never even touched on most of the speed metal stuff or whatever, but in fact one of the fastest bands in the world used to be the Beatles. When they played gigs in the early 60s, there was so much screaming that nobody could hear them, so they would do a half-hour set in 20 minutes just to get off early. So they speeded up all their songs just so they could finish the gig early. So they were the ultimate speed metal band. So most metal looking, we're going to get into fashion now. We're going to get into the look of a band. But, I mean, what does most metal looking really mean?
I can't believe
mean?
I didn't bring up King Diamond for this one. I'm ashamed.
Yeah, I didn't think of it either. Damn it.
Well, we'll call up a picture of them. Don't worry. So got a few suggestions, you know, as Ghost, Immortal, Motorhead, and I have my reasons for putting them on here, and Steel Panther. I also have reasons for putting them on here, but we'll call up some more as well. What does metal looking really mean? I mean,
look at Judas Priest, metal band. Hellbent for Leather.
I was fixing to say, I'm old. Judas Priest. Yeah, that's the measuring stick.
So,
now,
so
you can
leather
go
is a thing.
Way above it or way below it, but that's, you know, metal.
Leather
spikes
is a thing.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's really then, where the leather and studs look came from. Mm-hmm.
And this is Soul Assassins Nailed while I put Motorhead in here. They have the classic black jeans, black t-shirt or vest, and jean jacket black biker jacket look.
They also started the whole bullet belt trend.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that's true. Have you seen
classic look.
Have you seen Judas Priest before Rob went to the gay bondage store?
Yeah.
And they kind of look like hippies?
Oh, yeah. They did. Well, yep. Their first two or three albums, they were kind of hippie-ish. Mm-hmm. They had caftans and whatever. It was a bit weird.
Yeah, they had like purple plaid bell bottoms.
Yeah, yeah.
Sinatra Sin is really where that changed.
Yeah.
The biker / Yahtzee hat version of Rob Halford is what I'm talking about. That version of the band. I always pictured that as what a metal band looks like.
Indeed, yeah. And they could have been very well could have been on here. But I thought Steel Panther was an interesting choice because you take all those hair metal bands, and there are many of them. This is the ultimate.
And do a perfect parody of all of them.
That screams, that screams 80s right there. It really
it's
does.
A perfect parody, and it looks better than the rest of them.
Do not light a cigarette around these guys.
They've certainly aged better than Vince Neil.
I mean, there's enough product there to end the ozone layer. And
that was one of the things I said about what makes like that look. For a metal band, I said long hair or the hair. I mean, not for everyone, but.
Well,
I'd say you're right. Especially like if you look at the original, like when the thrash scene was coming up, every member in every band had long hair. It didn't matter if it was Metallica, Slayer, Megadeth, Anthrax, Testament, Exodus, Overkill, Death
Angel. You
had to
be able to headbang.
All of them. Now, and then you can look even at like the Arizona stuff, like Sacred Reich. You can look at the New Jersey stuff, like Overkill. Like they all had, it didn't matter if you're from the Bay Area, from New York, it didn't matter if Arizona, or even from the other countries, like Germany, the Teutonic Four, Creator, Sodom, Destruction, and Tankard. They all had long hair, all of them.
So I think Priest, could very well be known here. I did think about it, but I was trying to keep it to four bands per slide. And just leave the rest for chat, and we're doing that. So Judas Priest, King Diamond, they are archetypes. They look, you would not mistake them for any other kind of band. Also in here though, so Motorhead, there's that look that we're talking about. You know, biker jackets, either black leather or black jeans, t-shirts, black t-shirts.
This photo's sad to look at. because all these guys are no longer living. All of them.
Classic lineup too. That's the classic.
Yeah. That's a no. It's a great lineup. It's just seems full of think, man. All of them are not with us anymore. Like holy.
It's kind of weird, isn't it? Kind of weird.
Yeah.
Like, because bands have lost members, but I don't know of many bands that all of the original lineup is gone.
Most even older bands, there's at least one guy left, you know.
There's usually at least one with Motorhead. It's not, I mean, you can obviously talk about the later members, like obviously Phil Campbell's still alive, and Mickey D has been rocking with the Scorpions since Let Me Pass, which is, you know, hey, awesome for Mickey D. Obviously, he's not had to worry about, you know, sitting down at home doing nothing. But I've not heard from Phil Campbell.
Phil has his Phil Campbell and the Bastard Sons.
Yeah, but for me, this was the lineup. I mean, I love the other guys too, but this is the lineup I saw live, and it will always stay with me.
This look, if you're talking about like the look of it, this to me, this is like metal.
This is the epitome of like the metal and punk look.
And punk, yeah. I was going to say and punk too, because you got the buttons, you know what I mean? Or the whatever you want to call them on their jackets.
Buttons.
Yeah, but yeah, we used to call them buttons. The little
German eagle on Lemmy's sleeve.
I had loads of those.
Yeah, and the studs, and then the bullet belts. Exactly. Yep. And then, of course, the leather pants or, you know, or the tight black jeans type thing.
Yeah. Hey, yeah, so I got a bullet belt around here somewhere.
I had one back in the day.
If you look in the private chat, Imperatus is going a different direction with it, though. That's very credible.
Wait till you see what Immortal looks like before you say anything.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
King Diamond. And Immortal, yeah, I can see the Immortal resemblance. Mm-hmm. Big style here.
Yeah, that's the version of King Diamond I dressed up for on Halloween 2008.
Nice.
That's cool. Very Alice Cooper. Cool.
Yeah. He's like the perfect Halloween costume to mimic, because it's got like all of the Halloween themes in there. We've got like the kind of like the dressy outerwear with the bone jacket and all that.
Yeah. And I made the inverted cross necklace. And so my mom saw me like painting this cross that I had cut. And then I went in the other room so she wouldn't see me hang it upside down.
Yeah. Fair.
The Batman. Yes.
Yeah. So that's and that's a cool picture. Yeah. Very, very good quality as well. I mean, so Motorhead, hang on, Immortal. Which is kind of I mean, there's always been that makeup.
The panda bear look. Makeup.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Kiss with a metal slant.
Yeah, it's more like Kiss except not pussies. I mean, except
Kiss, the Gene Simmons version, right?
Well, yeah. With these guys, these guys also had aliases too. Like, if you look at all their individual names, like obviously the main head honcho of Immortals, Abeth. So they also have, like, you know, besides the panda bear makeup, and obviously they're super, super drenched in studs and leather, just like, you know, traditional heavy metal band. Yeah, and the course thing, that was a big thing. And, you know, interestingly enough, one of my buddies, he's Hellhammer's drum tech, and Hellhammer's the drummer for Mayhem. And he used to work for Michael Schenker from the Scorpions. Oh, and he told me that Schenker was the ultimate douchebag to work with. He treated his entire crew like crap.
Really?
But then him and his other crew members decided to quit on Schenker mid-tour. So they all quit on him. And they quit. And then about a week later, he got a call saying, hey, you know, would you like to take care of Hellhammer on Mayhem's tour coming up? And I was just like, dude, what if Mayhem tries to kill you? He's just like, that's what I mean. Like that could be a problem. Mayhem tries to kill you. Like, I mean, you just got off a tour with Schenker, and then I remember he finished the entire tour and he lived. I'm like, wow, dude, they didn't kill you. And they even spent Thanksgiving together in the most Mayhem type of fashion you can imagine. And yeah, I was like, what if they kill all the members? And they're like, okay, Brian, everyone is dead. You have to play now. Because a lot of those guys have convictions on their records in the Norwegian area.
And Mayhem is a infamous band for
legality. We're getting to
legality.
Them. We're going to get to them.
Okay.
Another thing I want to mention about the fashion part of it is, I forget what these things were called. The
bracers?
Yeah.
Yes, thank you. That's like very...
That's a very black metal thing.
Well, the thing with the black metal imagery, like the leather, the spikes kind of going over the top and the face paint and everything was, at least from what they said, with, you know, interviews from the 90s, they were saying like how the death metal underground metal scene just got, hey, look, it's a guy that lives next door to me on stage. They kind of lost that, for lack of a better term, pomp and circumstance behind the show. Yeah, and they took the old style, like the old Motorhead style, and just cranked it up a bit more. And kind of, in some cases, with these guys especially, went tongue-in-cheek with it.
Yeah, they just cranked it up to an absolutely comical degree.
There is an element of tongue-in-cheek here, that's for sure. I don't think these instruments are very playable, though, that they're holding.
That axe is also not practical in the slightest.
It's not strung very well.
No.
And then Ghost, of course, which is a very interesting look. I mean,
I was going to bring them up.
I don't know how you would. It's kind of medieval religious, but also Renaissance era France with the masks, and it's.
Well, one of the best ways I've heard Ghost described is they're either a rock band disguised as a satanic cult, or a satanic cult disguised as a rock band, and no one's really sure which, including the band.
Right, yeah, and what is it? Ritual was one of the most evil songs ever.
Voted for. Yeah, it had the most evil riff.
So catchy, dude. Yeah, oh man, yeah. I remember because that was when they put out their first album, Opus Eponymous, and that was when all their identities were still a secret identity, even though their singer is also was in a death metal band called Repugnant. But at the time, Ghost was like, I was like, oh man, hey, these guys are cool. I remember I went to a show where only a few hundred people knew who they were. And that was cool to say that like then. And like, dude, I listened to Opus obsessively. And then, then there was one of my buddies knew the opening band. They're called Skeleton Witch. He's like, hey, dude, you want to go to the green room with Skeleton Witch? I'm thinking, man, yeah, I want to do that. So for you know, we're passing a bowl around and getting high, getting stoned. Now I'm really baked. And I look to the right of me and I see Charlie Benante from Anthrax. I'm like, what the fuck? I'm too stoned for this shit. I see Charlie Benante. Also, I look to I see the Skeleton Witch guys. Then some guy approaches me and he has a very strongly accented voice. He's like, did you enjoy the show? I was just like, what? Hey, he's like, with the show. I'm like, oh, yeah, no, show is awesome. Ghost is kick ass, you know, saying all the things. And I looked at his press pass. It's a Ghost on there. And then I found out from one of the Skeleton Witch guys, like, oh, that was one of the Ghost guys. I was just like, what? And then I saw them all bunch up later, and I talked to the rest of the guys. They wouldn't give their names at the time. So whenever they did signatures, they did, like, specifically like symbols or letters because they're so under wrap. But however, the twist, my buddy had a Repugnant album and Papa Emeritus, aka Tobias Forge, signed his Repugnant album. I was just like, holy crap. And that was before the secret identity is out. So we were like, we will not tell anyone about this happening. And we never did. So you can never accuse us for getting the secret identities out.
Yeah, that's a really cool story. I mean, has anyone seen these guys? I mean, like, I've seen them once. Do you see their faces ever?
No, the band members, no. Him, yes, but even that, the band members change constantly.
Yeah, they could be interchangeable then.
Well, they're called nameless ghouls.
Well, yeah, and the guys you see on tour are not the guys who played on the album. Usually,
right? Okay.
They'll get a whole bunch of new musicians in.
So, yeah. Well, and my understanding is that when he does interviews, he dresses as one of the nameless ghouls, and instead of as Papa, and he claims that that they do everything and Papa does nothing, and so at least before their identities were released.
So this is a little bit of them.
They're musically pretty interesting too.
Well, this is actually pretty neat musically. Certainly not overwrought. This is on Jimmy Kimmel's show.
Yep.
So they're starting to get mainstream TV by this time.
What? Yeah, they're huge now.
Cool.
Yeah. And are they really satanic, or are they just, is it just an act? You know,
Tobias actually is.
But so besides Tobias, I think Tobias is the real deal, but everyone else is, it's just kind of a gimmick. Because, and also, yeah, remember too, they've changed members many times. Like, they've not always said when they changed members. The only time that they made it public was when a few of them put out a legal lawsuit against Tobias Forge. But everyone else, a lot of the guys have. So it just, it depends on person to person. Kind of like the way Slayer is. Some of the guys actually are, some of them aren't, but yet they still work together.
I do admire their pandemic outfits they've got on, though.
that was fully intentional. Like, they ran with that. This is off their new album.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's
so they just kind of, they leaned into it and just ran with it.
You look a little bit like they're at Fallout New Vegas as well.
Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah. But this is funny, actually a very balanced song. It's really quite nice, you know. It's,
you know, they put out a plague themed album before the actual prequel. Plague.
Yeah. So almost musically prophetic. Not necessarily what you would expect when you see images, you know. It's quite sensitive.
One of the only metal bands I've ever seen have a saxophone solo in one of their songs.
All right, yeah.
Really? Wow.
Yep, Miasma. It's a great song.
Yeah, you don't hear that very often. So, that's for sure.
Who else did we have in this category of best dressed? Oh, yes. Sorry, I got some. I don't know if I can get this to work. There we go. So we had Motorhead. We had Motorhead, of course, the classic Luke with the classic lineup. The bullet belt. Yeah, there's the bullet belt. I'd like to claim I did all these titles, but I didn't.
You know, I was just listening to their 1916 album this morning.
It's pretty solid good. Record. I love the title track.
That's the thing. Like, for me, Motorhead, like, it wasn't just, you know, with the stuff they did with Overkill and Ace of Spades, but the stuff that they did throughout their career for me was excellent. I love 1916. I love Sacrifice. That's one of my favorite Motorhead albums, period. And then, of course, what was that one? Inferno that they put on 2004. Smoking album.
My first ever review on YouTube was Bad Magic, their last record.
Oh, Bad Magic.
Such a solid record, too.
I even love the cover version album. I love the covers. The cover versions they did.
I just want to say hi to Papa Cotton in the
Hey, Papa.
His avatar.
Hey.
You summoned him.
Yeah.
He has appeared.
Should we, Papa. Steel Panther, should we have Always Gonna Be a Hoe or She's Tight?
That's a very good question.
I'll go for She's Tight.
I was going to say, that's what I would lean
people make comments
right
about
there.
Black metal song titles.
Oh, yeah.
Given it's a cheap, I'm a huge Cheap Trick fan, I'll go for this one. But that's the ultimate hair metal look.
I just want that amp.
Oh, Lord.
Holy moly. There's some good points in this video. One of my favorite songs, When Done by Cheap Trick.
Such a waste of a 5150. Just sitting there with these guys.
I was thinking they look like a bunch of David Lee Roth fans. You know.
See, they could have been in Silliest too, but there's a Silliest category coming up. But...
You're this cheap slut.
And then also we had Immortal in this category. So, or we had that already? I can't remember.
Yeah, you showed a picture of them. We hadn't seen any of the music yet.
Let's hope they're not strikers.
There's actually a good newer heavy metal band nowadays out called Striker. Pretty good, actually.
Yeah, I've heard of that. Yeah.
Yeah, they're good. They're doing the whole traditional heavy metal sound, and they're good. And it's very impressive that we've had this like wave of killer trad metal coming out like that's inspired by particularly like the second wave of bands, you know, like Judas Priest, Saxon, Heaven to Hell era, Black Sabbath.
Well,
like,
Pope's been
really
getting me
cool
into a lot of this stuff.
Out.
Yeah, Pope's been getting me into loads of those.
And some of the older bands are actually coming back. Like I just found out apparently a couple of years ago, Tigers of Pantang released another record.
Oh, yeah. Yes, they did. Yes, they did.
I can't remember the name of the festival, but Anthrax is on tour with Black Label Society and a bunch of other bands right now.
And then Saxon Wars created the album of the year this year with Carpe Diem.
Oh, man. Saxon's album is so good.
Well,
dude,
we'll be having a bit of Saxon later.
Good.
Spreading out. Spreading the goodness out. So that's Immortal. It's a look. I mean, you can certainly identify them.
And the scary part is Tiger is also a mailman.
Oh, yeah. But the black and white suits them. Like, they're a band you should see in black and white.
Yeah, I don't think they've ever done a video in color. Well, no, they did. I should actually bring that
video. Abbath did. As you count Abbath.
And Paris, is this a video they tried to film on a glacier?
No, no. This they did an older one because it had Hellhammer as the drummer from the Battles in the North album.
Should I play this video up here, Bathory?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
I always say that bands like this should film where I'm currently in Colorado because we have like all the cool aspen trees, you know, the white trees, and like you could have like the best like metal video. The snow and the ice.
Wow, you don't even have to search hard for what I'm looking for. Darius knows what I'm looking for.
Yes, that's the best. Let me is God. What,
Fall of the Winter Moon?
Yeah. When I say tongue-in-cheek, these guys are tongue-in-cheek. This is why. This is 100% why.
That was some of our best-looking metal bands, so... what have we got up next? If unless anyone's got any more suggestions for bands that just look, I mean, we had Judas Priest. We'll see them later. We'll see a little bit of them later.
Actually, let me bring you up a King Diamond video.
Yeah.
Because his whole stage presence, the stage setup, all adds to his image.
Well, there's another Immortal one you shoot.
Yeah. Well, this is, well...
It's in color,
Immortal, man. Esom before he changed drastically.
No, this wasn't Esom. This was Abbath.
Hold on. Yeah, you're right. Mistaken for Emperor. Yeah.
What
would black metal bands do without forests?
ask Carpathian Forest. Indeed. Forest would know.
We're gonna get them later. They're coming on later.
Oh, are they really?
Yeah. You didn't think I was gonna bring them up? Come on now, Nick.
He looks a bit like a dwarf wizard here. He's a bit of a wizard.
Yeah, this was like they were still kids when they did this. They were still teenagers.
Oh, right. Hence the VHS quality.
When I saw this for the first time, it was my buddy had a VHS tape of nothing but black metal videos that they got from Europe and whatnot. And it was this video, but right before it was some Norwegian newscast or talk show. The guys, blah, 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 Norwegian black metal. You know, probably saying how this is a great threat to the country or whatever. Except during the time of all the church burnings. And plays this video and cuts back to him and the look on his face is, you're fucking kidding me, right? We're worried about this.
Already burnt.
When I think of black metal, I think of Burzum. But I don't think they...
Same era.
Yeah, definitely
they never,
same
like,
era.
Later. Did they not do live shows or something? What was the whole
A lot of those bands in either A, come to America because of conditions... And you know,
or just didn't play live.
Some of them just didn't play live, like Corthon and Bathory. Yeah. They only did like what, two shows ever?
I think they toured the U.S. once, and they never did it again.
Yeah, Abigor's never played live.
Even their home country, they barely play. Dark. There's a lot of those bands. They don't play. Always do many shows. Some of them just do very minimal. Then you have bands who absolutely tour. Like Mayhem and Watain, where they actually do, you know, full-length tours when they come to the States.
Dude, Watain tours all the time.
Yeah, 1349 as well.
Yeah, 1349. Take, when they used to come to America before they had the Antifa confrontation, they were actually playing the States, even though they somehow got into a country despite Hoss's convictions on his record, which I was shocked because I could say I was there for Take's first U.S. show. No one thought they were going to get into the country because of his convictions, but he got in. I was just like, wow, that is the dumbest luck ever. But then that whole confrontation happened. Then I think Marduk struck back at all are those type of crowds who are trying to get their shows canceled as well.
Yeah, they did.
That was what, 2017 and 18, I think that happened.
Yeah, 2017, I think maybe even 2016. because that was
the Marduk thing.
Yeah,
yeah, Marduk. Actually, Razorfist, I think, did a video.
Yeah, he did. He did. He was pretty much laughing at the Antifa people. Like, you really picked the wrong band and fans to fuck with.
Yeah, pretty much.
So we're moving on to silliest band.
Oh man,
get some real crackers in this one.
I see a couple there that I'm already laughing at. Yeah.
And I'm enjoying this because there's a Scottish band in here. So
there's two Scottish bands in here.
Well, yeah, actually, to be fair, there are two linked by one guy, isn't it? So.
I'm surprised there aren't more Canadian bands down here. On here, and if you're going to include Cradle of Filth, you got to include 3 Inches of Blood.
I could, but that's enough about my sex life.
oh, that metal.
So, Glory Hammer, which ones is it? And it's funny, I was thinking, you know, wouldn't it be great if they did a song called Glory Hole?
Well, I'm not so sure they
look like a D&D group, man.
Somebody did. It was either them or Steel Panther.
if it between the two, probably Steel Panther. But
I think Steel Panther did do Glory Hole, but
I mean, these guys, you're talking a band that did a song called The Unicorn Invasion of Dundee. So it's just the most gloriously, ridiculously Scottish thing I've ever heard in my life.
I know. Well, that's why we are silly. We're a silly people. But yeah, Glory Hammer. Christopher Bowes is the guy that links both bands. Yeah, but he's. But I love the hammer. It's an actual hammer. It is the Glory Hammer. And I guess you would call them a little bit more symphonic than you would. They're not black metal or anything.
They're more symphonic or power metal.
Yeah.
One of my buddies' bands open for these guys, and I'm just like, wow, this just sounds weird to say you're opening for Glory Hammer. Like, it's just a very weird passage.
Yeah, right. Have you seen my Glory Hammer?
I'll laugh at name till I'm dead.
Yeah, and then we'll move on to... I like the backdrop as well. I wonder if they filmed it on an actual alien planet. But, then we have Cradle of Filth, who I think are pretty silly, but that's just me. Some people think they're wonderful. I mean, they're okay. Don't get me wrong. I think they're a little bit silly.
The deer antlers really sell it.
Yeah. I think somebody in the chat mentioned that it's all about emo and vomit, and emo's vomiting.
Yeah, Papa said that they're too emo and into vomit.
Yeah. But, you know, they have a look. I'm just not quite sure it's a look I'm that keen on, you know. So then we have Twisted Sister.
Razor Fist's best friend.
Oh, God.
Definitely silly. This is what Steel Panther would look like if they weren't good.
Yeah, right?
That's funny. That's funny.
Oh, my gosh. Still one of the greatest lead-ins to a music video ever, though. With that guy oh God, I loved that movie when I was a kid. Animal House. Yeah, whatever his name was. Drop and Give Me 20. Just awesome. Yeah.
And then D had to fuck it all up because he had to run his mouth on Twitter repeatedly.
He's an idiot. Yeah.
But definitely silly. Very, very silly. It is a silly place. And then we have the other Scottish band.
Ailstorm is freaking Ailstorm,
Ailstorm with the pirate metal.
Now I gotta tell you guys something. You know, I'm doing a comic book about America's pirate patriot, the privateer. That's his picture right behind me, right? They actually do a cover of an old sea shanty called Barrett's Privateers, and that's his theme song. But it's the sea shanty, not the
Ailstorm.
Yeah.
But I'm pleased to find there was actually a couple of Scottish acts I could put on the list.
And my favorite with Ailstorm has to be what should be the U.S. Navy's theme song from now on, Fucked with an Anchor.
See you, Dustin. Take care. Dustin's got to go. Nice to see you.
I've heard a lot of this band. My buddy has likes them, so.
They got to have some money behind them. I'll tell you what. You watch their videos, and they're high production.
Well, we're going to have a quick look at them if we can. Yeah. I've got some lined up. So let's start with that then and see if we can get away with it as usual.
Isn't there one where they're fighting a big sea monster on the boat?
Keelhauled and Hoots Force, which I think is good. Hoots being a Scottish term, of course. Hootsman. This is when I like Keelhauled. And you get the folky Celtic thing going on, obviously.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
We'll flip forward to get some music. There we go.
But I am not an evil man. So first let's have a little fun. We'll tie that scoundrel to a rope and throw him overboard. Grab him underneath the ship. A terrifying, deadly trip. Kill all that filthy landlubber. Send him down to the depths below. Make that bastard walk the plank with a bottle of rum and a yo.
I think it's a really neat thing they're doing, you know.
Yeah, it is. It's definitely neat. I, like I said, I knew about the song Barrett's Privateers, and I was searching for it one day, and came up with one of their videos. That's the only reason why I even know who they are. And I was intrigued by the look and the sound, and I started watching some of their stuff.
They're quite good. I like them a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're fun. They're a lot of fun. But, this is the Hoots Force for Glory Hammer. But Hoots, I mean, that's Hootsman, very Scottish. Hoots Force. Just...
If we ever allowed different Scotland theme. To leave the planet.
Indeed. Well, a lot of people have tried to take it off the planet. But...
So maybe the definition of silliest means that it's metal bands that have gone commercial? Because all of these look like they're high production value videos.
Right? I think they're having a lot of fun, which is part of it. And they're not taking themselves deadly seriously.
Not at all. Yeah.
But the music's still pretty good.
Yeah. That's the cool thing with these bands is like, you'll see some really talented musicians that just don't take themselves seriously at all.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thing is, the lyrics of this are really nothing to do with space, but it's set in space.
That's part of the funny part of it is like they build themselves as a sci-fi band. Almost none of it has to do anything to do with science fiction.
This is all about medieval kings and fighting. Yeah.
I could see this playing at a tabletop gaming convention, man.
Oh yeah,
yeah, for sure.
So we had a bit of Cradle of Filth, just sort of. And I don't know, it's not knocking the music, putting them in the silliest category. I just think they embody a lot of traits that could be seen as a little bit adopted. They've adopted them. And they've gone much more symphonic these days, and there used to be a lot more black metal, I would say. But
yeah, they let go of a lot of the black metalish elements, besides the constant blast beating on the drums, which is pretty much the only black metal element that's in there nowadays. They've kind of went more towards this phonic tone for about 15 years now.
Yeah, their first two albums were very much so black metal.
Yeah.
Oh yes.
They do a lot of the satanic stuff, but they are just. Playing at it, I think you know it's for image. They're into the image, but
I think it's all image too. Now, if there's a band like Satyricon, they're the real deal. Which interestingly, I saw Satyricon open for Cradle of Filth, and Satyricon ruled, man.
Yeah,
I remember. Band. Oh, Satyricon was awesome.
I have another silly after this to add to the list. I don't know
Go
if you mentioned it, but or if it was on the thing, but Tenacious D.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah, yes. Yeah. Yeah.
They were for sure. They're ridiculous.
But they are.
That's right. Yeah.
They are.
And he counts as metal because he had Ronnie James Dio on a couple of his tracks. Yeah.
And they had to take it seriously when they were doing it, even though you know it's funny, which is the best.
Oh, yeah.
So there was somebody here at a ska metal. No, we didn't see. There's so much stuff we just can't get
there's
to.
Like polka metal and stuff. There's a lot of like.
Assuming Ailstorm is what Papa Cotton's referring to as men without hats plugged in. He could be right.
Well, me and Pope and Imperator spent an hour and a half just dissecting, 10 albums, maybe 15 from, 1988 or 9?
Yep.
That was an hour and a half of just that one year with a handful of albums. Like, can you imagine if I wanted to go extra and say, hey, let's look at another 20 or 30 from one of those years? And those years all had great deeper cut albums that I guess you could say aren't as highly regarded magazines, but if you look for the fans out there who are into them, they are absolutely as into it as a lot of the bigger, more known bands. Like, no one talked about, or sorry, maybe I shouldn't say no one, but nowhere as many people talked about Death Angel back in the day, like the way right. they do now. And Death Angel was one of the first, they're one of the, you know, first of the thrash metal bands. And back then, they're kind of even playing the diversity quota with them too, but they told they wanted to be known for their music because they were all Filipino at the time.
Yep.
But they said, just listen to our music. You need to talk about how young we are, what we look, just see what our music is. And then they had an incident, a very devastating car crash that cost their career. Then they reformed in the 2000s. And Death Angel, to this day, same thing with YouTube. I was going to say, would YouTube it'd say, hey, look at all these bands you may have missed. You miss Morbid Saint, Dark Angel, Tankard, Demolition Hammer. Like,
Metal Church always kind of flew under the radar, too.
Yeah, a little bit.
Not as much as those bands did. No, I mean, the Metal Church were perfectly somewhere in the middle of all those, because they weren't as well known as, like, an Anthrax or Suicidal Tendencies, but they're definitely bigger than your Demolition Hammers of the world. They had a nice, sweet middle.
Mm-hmm. So, Imperatus, tell me a little bit about these guys, because I'm not...
Fintroll, they're a band from Finland who sings in Swedish because they say it makes them sound more trollish.
So you're gonna say you swing both ways.
Best way I could just describe them is if Danny Elfman had a fever dream and it became a death metal band.
Wow. I can see the Danny Elfman, fair. This is great. I love this animation. It is awesome.
Yeah, this is, you know, they're into it just for the sake of making music and what they're doing as well. This kind of stuff.
This is a lot of fun. Yeah. I'm going to have to put
this
on
the
list.
The video. This is great animation. I like this.
Love it. Yeah. I love
it. Very cool.
And of course, we have to talk about the elephant in the room with silly bands, Spinal Tap.
Of course.
Well, indeed.
I think that goes without saying, though.
Yeah, it does.
Stonehenge.
It is on my list of shows to do, which is to do a fake band special. You'll definitely be in there, of course. We're going to do a fake band special one day. And Spinal Tap will obviously be at number one in that. But so
Fintroll, Darkness. Would people think they were silly?
They were kind of silly, but...
they were good.
They were all right.
I think it was... Because they took what they were doing seriously in a silly way, it wasn't just accidentally silly, you know?
Yeah, I'm not so sure that that wasn't, you know, intentional. Like, they weren't doing it intentionally, but it came across as, like, really over the top and silly.
The first band that popped into my mind when you said silly was an all-female band called Vixen from the 80s.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, Vixen.
You want to talk about big hair band.
They were actually all right, though.
They were
deep, but, you know, just the look of them and everything was...
Did you really see hairy bands? How do you know they were hairy? So if hairy guys and hairy girls are just as welcome in metal.
There you go.
This is King Diamond.
And this was mid-2010s. And bear in mind, the guy's in his 60s, I believe, during this set.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think. I swear they played with Motorhead.
Yeah, they have.
I'm sorry. I think that's who I saw them play with. It was in DC. I forgot the name of the club.
Imperatus is in this crowd somewhere.
9:30.
No, this was in LA, and I've never been to LA. Nor do I.
Otherwise, you would have been.
Yeah, probably.
Oh, it says Live at the Fillmore in Philadelphia.
Oh, the Fillmore,
Oh, okay. Never mind then. I thought this was...
Fillmore in Philly?
Yep. So maybe you were at that show, Courtney.
Fillmore East, I guess.
Fillmore?
Mm-hmm. That's what it says in the caption. Yeah.
So that was...
I have never heard of a Fillmore in Philadelphia.
Oh, we have a Fillmore in Detroit.
There's a Fillmore in Denver.
Not attacking you, Das Wolf, and these are all fun bands, honestly. Some of them are on the silliest, and they could easily be in the other lists, but I'm trying to spread it about a bit. So.
I need to find this out.
Honestly, mate, not attacking them. I've loved everything we've shown so far, even the silly stuff. So, but tell us, my friend, your favorite band will never show up in any list. Farmer's Rock. God, you have to, who is it, Kitty Bear? Who's, tell us, my friend. Who's your favorite band?
Let us know. I'm not familiar with Farmer's Rock.
Well, Neil Young might have done a little couple of things that were like that, like his version of Farmer John. That's probably, well, Farmer Rock.
And we've seen recently that the Dutch farmers are pretty metal already.
Yeah.
Well, one of them did show up to that protest with a Sherman Firefly. Yeah. I don't know where they found it, but
anyone that can dump piles of shit on the main road is good by me.
Like, can you imagine manning a barricade as like a Dutch cop or whatever, and then someone rolls up in a tank? Just like, oh, hell no.
BB metal. It's metal by very small people.
Yeah. No, they're a Japanese group of
women. No, okay, I've heard of that. Yeah, I've heard of them. I like, there's some kick-ass Japanese bands. Yeah, well, one day we'll have to get to that as a theme. But, so that was the silliest category. What have we got next in our exploration of the
corners? While you're transitioning, it just registered to my head one of the absolutely loudest bands I ever saw live. And they're not fully metal, but they're somewhere in between metal and industrial. Is Godflesh. Godflesh. They have very simple riffage, minimal lyrical delivery. It does rely on repetition, but holy crap. When I first heard Godflesh, I couldn't believe like what I was hearing, especially when I saw them live. It was on another level. I was just like, holy crap. Like the song Like Rats was the first time I ever heard from Godflesh. And yeah, and they're definitely one of those bands that it's definitely a thing that a lot of those fans can agree on, whether they're a pure, you know, underground metalhead or even an industrial fan.
They have a music video directed by Andre Serrano, the guy that uses bodily fluids?
They this might have. Normal. That sounds like something Godflesh would do.
This is for Kitty Bear. This is way back, 73. I like your hat. Hang on, I gotta turn it up. Top Pop, if they've posted this, they'll strike the shit out of me. Take it, this is what you're looking for, Kitty Bear. Funkin, that sounds a bit
rude. Fremden.
Okay, I'm gonna get into this. Normal. I'm gonna write this down. See, it's from the 70s, so I'm into this.
It's like country music done by Europeans. I'm not sure how I feel about it.
Yeah. It's like ABBA if they were unwashed. All right, well, we've had a look at them, but I bet they've had a long career. This is just early days. But when I was
blown away that there
is
a Fillmore in Philadelphia, but they didn't open it till 2015. That's why I don't know about it.
When I was a young lad, this is what we would have thought European pop music was like, because we were from Britain and we had all the good stuff.
The tiny guitar.
Right. Okay. Stephen Paul is Dutch slang for boner again. Okay. Well, I'll look more into that offline, because now we're going to get into the category we've all been waiting for, the most offensive.
Oh, wow.
Man, there that's up for debate. I don't know.
Oh, we're going to have some serious debate here. Now, there are four choices there, but that doesn't mean they're the only ones. So, Carpathian Forest, Rammstein, Marduk, and Mayhem. I think Mayhem will leave for last in many ways. But so Rammstein, obviously, are offensive, but more in a kind of a we're trying to provoke you kind of way by making songs about tits and dismembering things and
cannibalism.
Cannibalism. I was going to say, I was in Cannibal Corpse on this list.
I debated about that. I didn't know how far to go.
Well, you don't have to show things, but we can name some.
We can
things.
Talk
I mean,
about
they had
them,
a song. I mean, they had a song called "Orgasm Through Torture." Like,
isn't that what it always is, though, Nick? Do not come, or else.
Well, they had a song "I Come Blood" from Tomb of the Mutilated. I come blood. That was a classic. That
if you're not using a car battery, you're not having fun yet.
4 million volts. So I think I think Rammstein are definitely banned in a number of places for various reasons.
Well, they've got banned for their live shows. Yeah. Yeah, they had a giant custard shooting dildo that would
to me, it's just kind of Alice Cooper on steroids. Gwar could be on here. Gwar could have been on here.
Oh, Gwar could have been on here. I remember I saw them kill. I remember I saw them kill George Bush and Bill Clinton on stage. It was great. They killed everyone. Great
well, that's no not one offensive. That welcome.
Their power. They killed Paris Hilton. Them. That was awesome. Oh, I was just like, I couldn't stand her too, so I was perfect.
And the band is
seeing Das Wolf. Which band?
Which band, Das Wolfen?
And the band, there's one band we haven't talked about yet that started the PMRC craze was Wasp.
Oh,
I hadn't thought about that. Yeah, you're right. We're just waiting for Das Wolfen to tell us who's going to see. Could be Rammstein, of course. We've also got Marduk on here.
Oh, he's seeing Gwar next month. Dude, nice. And that's Gwar, killer, nice. Man. No, by all means, go. Have a great time. I've seen him like seven or eight times.
I didn't put Marilyn Manson on here. It's partly because I'm not that keen, and I don't know.
But Marduk, their song titles, some of them will get you just straight up banned if you even put it in the chat or say it on the stream. It will get struck.
Yeah. He's right.
So and one of the ones I don't think we'll get banned for is Fist Fucking God's Planet.
Wow.
It's a song. I bought my grandmother a copy of that for Christmas 1 year. Carpathian Forest, of course, is on a lot of people's lists.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
And what else have we got in here? We have Mayhem. And Mayhem are a thing in their own right.
Well,
I know we're talking more metal. Dead.
Sorry, Courtney, go ahead.
I was just going to say, I know we're talking metal, but when I think most offensive of all time, I always think G.G. Allin.
Yep.
Oh, yeah.
Takes the cake. Yeah.
Well, Dead blew his own head off. And then he actually became dead. I mean, yeah.
And they took a picture and used it for a bootleg album cover at that.
That's, yeah.
Dawn of the Black Arts. It's a bootleg, but it's the picture of Dead from Mayhem laying in bed with his brains blown out.
Yep. The blackmail guys, man, they were very for real.
I have to admit, I've not actually seen any of these bands myself live. So who's seen any of them, and what was it like?
I have. I've seen three of the four.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which one didn't you see? Who have you not seen?
I was supposed to have seen Carpathian Forest, and they had this really weird thing. They're supposed to be on this festival called Maryland Death Fest in 2013. They're scheduled to be on the festival, and a few members got approved to get kind of country, and a few of them didn't. It wasn't even like they had some conviction. They had like border issues where they're waiting for their visas on time. So since they couldn't play the festival, the members that did make it into country, obviously they didn't play, but they decided we'll just hang out in the crowd with the fans and interact with the fans, which is what they did. They hung out the entire weekend in the crowd with the fans. If you know Abigor from the chat, he was there at that festival as well. So him and I may have crossed paths at one point during that festival, but I remember I was so bummed that Carpathian couldn't make it because he had a great lineup that year. You had Down, Phil Anselmo's other band, which is like his Black Sabbath stoner band, and you had Esom, which is, you know, Esom from Emperor. You had Sleep, you know, that's like the epitome of stoner doom rock, like with one song that's an hour long. Bolt Thrower, Carcass. Yeah, it was a big deal that year. But yeah, I have seen everyone else though many times.
Cool.
Yeah, I've seen Marduk and Rammstein.
Yeah, and your thoughts?
Rammstein was a hell of a show, although they've had to tone it way down with the pyrotechnics from their European shows because half the stage wasn't on fire at any given point. Marduk was really interesting. They were another one that was really loud. But it was mostly just the energy they were playing with was just fantastic.
Yeah. Crowd were into it, though.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, Kitty B, and I'm going to look this Normal up. And obviously they had a long career and did lots of different things. So what we saw there was an early piece. So I'm going to definitely look those up, mate. So, Papa Cotton, White Zombie, too mainstream to make the list. Devil Music, Volume 1 for the win. Definitely not too mainstream to make the list. They are on the list because you've now mentioned them. All I did was stuck four on each slide, but I wanted you guys to bring others forward for sure. So White Zombie, yeah, absolutely could be on there.
I could name a couple, but I don't want you to look them up because they're too offensive and they're not mainstream, but they've made it a little bigger. One of them is called Bad Luck 13, though. They're pretty
good. Oh, yeah. Cool. So we have some clips. Hopefully we will get away with those clips. this was a hard one to... we'll start with a bit of Carpathian Forest.
Good evening. Are you ready for some Norwegian black metal? This is a night of Norwegian black metal. This is Sodom.
I think he's playing Norwegian black metal.
I'm ready.
That's what I'm guessing from his intro. Oops. Might have to skip that one.
Oh, yeah. Oops.
Oops. Hey, I should warn you about that.
We get the gist. I didn't watch it all before I... It's funny, I picked one with a title I thought I could get away with. I thought, nobody's going to complain about Sadomasochism. Anyway. moving on.
And that album is actually called Fuck You All, so.
Yeah, well, I couldn't play that one. But we get the gist.
I'm finding one a little bit more YouTube.
Find me one that's there's no boobs. This is Marduk. I have no idea if these guys are going to be copyright strikers or whatever. But,
I also linked you another one, too. That was their official on YouTube, so okay, you might be able to get...
Thanks. I'll skip forward. Incredibly fast as well, this one.
These guys have also had some rather, shall we say, interesting artwork on some of their bootlegs.
You know who used to have a really insane drummer before they became more symphonic death metal? Flesh God Apocalypse. When they first started, mm-hmm. they're a band from Italy. And when I first heard their drummer, I was like, there is no way a human being can do what that drummer did.
Yeah.
And
I don't know how they do it. I mean, it's like they're playing four times the speed of a normal bass drum.
Oh, yeah.
That's a pedal setup.
When you hear Flesh God Apocalypse, I was just like, how is this real? And I thought, I got to see this for myself. When I saw them live, like, you know, the drummer actually, he makes it happen, man. He absolutely does. And I didn't think that that was possible, because what this drummer can do is not right. Let's just say, it's like, how is this happening? And then, like, they had... their singer does like these backing vocals that almost sound almost like something out of like an Italian opera to balance out the super guttural vocals. And yeah, that was when they're more straight death metal band. And then they went more the symphonic route, and they're fairly good now, but dude, I posted a link in the chat for people to check out. Look up Flesh God Apocalypse. And the guys all wore suits on stage too. Very, very classy. Those Italian bastards.
It's an interesting...
But yeah, look them up. Flesh God Apocalypse were awesome.
So this is a bit of Carpathian Forest we can play, because there's no visuals, which is good.
I would consider this song to be a black metal anthem.
Yeah.
Not just because of the song title, but just the song itself. It's... got a couple of really just nasty fucking leads in it.
I'm hoping we can play a little bit of this without getting... nobody started to take the stream down yet, so we're okay. I don't mind claims. Copyright claims, fine. I'm not monetized. So.
Strikes are,
So the Vixen's still performing. The drummer is the only original. This is what you tend to find now after all these years.
I think one of them's dead,
isn't she? Yeah, when I said they were silly, I meant the motif of them. I actually bought their album. I thought it was pretty cool. So, you know.
Oh, I've seen White Snake live, and it was just, they tried to burn the house down for sure.
That's great. That's great. White, not White Snake, by the way.
Like, I guess White. If they had any balls, that's good. was good.
Anyway, so
no, I don't know. Yeah, I always thought Kiss was like Disney metal. You know what I mean? Trying to make it, to where, you know, everybody could consume it, kind of thing.
I have to agree. What have we not had? We haven't had a bit of Rammstein. Oh yeah, Kinda Lust. I was going to play.
The video for this is fucking hysterical.
Yeah, this is my favorite. I don't know if I want to play all of it because we're time and copyright factors.
That's a nice car.
It is. Sure. This is the get to the point where they're playing.
Yeah, they do have long intros on their videos.
Yeah, which is great when they're showing the titties.
And they actually have a song called Dick a Tit.
Yes, exactly. I do have that bookmarked up here. Dick a Tit.
This video is amazing.
I gotta say, either this or the one for Ishville is probably my favorite.
Oh yeah,
I can imagine this would upset a few people though. Fat shaming and all that.
Are they though?
I just thought they were doing a tribute to Elvis.
Yeah, and as far as offensive content, Mind Tile has to take the cake on that one.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Especially because it's a true story.
Yeah. Whatever you do, don't play the Auslander video.
I did look at it, but I decided not to. I did my research almost. Call. Apart from the Marduk. Sorry, oops, wrong one. My God, 538 subscribers. wrong button. And
I'm
then
sorry,
we have...
Papa Cotton's killing me in the chat, man.
He is, he's good, he's doing well. So I'll let Darius highlight those if he can. If he's able to. You do some highlighting if you don't mind, buddy. Thank you. So we'll play a bit of Mayhem, and this is a later version, I think.
Yeah.
Somebody, who was it that died?
Dead. Euronymous.
Yeah, you want to give me the rundown on these history of these guys? Because it's quite complex.
Yeah, these guys are, again, one of the infamous bands out of Norway in the 90s. Like, you had a Suicide, which again, the photo of said Suicide was used for an album cover. And reportedly some of the members took bits of his skull and turned him into necklaces.
Yep.
Ugh. And then another, you had a band murder. Confirmed that. Ugh. Another band confirmed they'd got a piece of that sent to them.
Funny story about what he's doing right there with the animal head. Those are real animal heads. And a buddy of mine years back clipped out of my local New York newspaper from their global section a story about some Norwegian heavy metal band named Mayhem, where he did the whole thing where he goes to lift up the animal head and it flew off of what he was lifting it with and out into the crowd and broke somebody's nose.
Wow.
Oh.
Oops. Yeah, it's a big oops.
Gross, but then that's a big oops. Yeah, with the nose.
Jeez. Then one of the founding members ended up getting stabbed 28 times.
By another member of the band.
By a supposed friend, which would be the guy from the band Burzum.
Hail Muslim Uncle.
Burzum has a bunch of stories.
Yeah, so that, just all sorts of chaos with these guys, from church burnings to murders to suicides to breaking people's faces with animal heads.
It's a terrible movie, and it's very inaccurate, but if you guys have ever seen the movie Lords of Chaos, This is the band it's about. Directed by Jonas Åkerlund of Bathory fame.
Oh, yeah.
Well, Bathory are seminal, I think is the word.
Yeah.
They're one of the OG black metal bands.
Yeah, a lot of these guys paid Emperor and others play tribute to them and play their songs. And
Venom as well.
Now, just so you'll be aware, according to Nick Riccata's rules, it's kind of funny you have this on right here. In about 7 minutes, 6 minutes, you can probably show the stuff that you weren't going to add into the show that was way too offensive to even put on YouTube. Right. Yeah. According to Nick, if you do it after 2 hours, you'd be okay.
I didn't know that. Well, we'll have to try
that. Because you know how crazy he gets at night. He sits there and he waits until after 2 o'clock to do his unbreaded segment, which is just totally offensive. And yeah. So
Courtney has mentioned in the private chat the name of a band that we can't see.
Yeah, you don't say that, right?
Oh, yeah.
It's got the initial A.
Yeah.
No. So just say something AC. Like Bottom Fanny.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's a British way of saying the other word.
Yeah.
Bottom Front Bottom would be the...
Yeah.
They're a great band, too, in my opinion. So,
the second word is every Australian's favorite insult.
Yeah. Tonight, live on Jimmy Kimmel. Yeah. It's...
I would have fucking died laughing if that ever happened.
I'm just sorry.
That would be the coolest thing he'd ever done if he did that.
As he's just reading off the card and like looks at his manager like, are you kidding?
Yes. Anal Kunt.
Yeah.
Close.
That's a good close.
I was thinking Brown IV, you know.
Kitty Bear's got a good point because I've seen AC/DC a few times and the whole place is shaking. It's great.
Yeah. D-Bud. Take care, dude. See you Friday.
D-Bud.
Take care, dude.
Here's D-Bud. Good to see you, my friend.
Bye, D-Bud.
Death to all but metal. Yeah. So that was some of our offensive ones, and thank you for the rundown on Mayhem, Peritus. They're one of the most... celebrate your offensive ones. You know, we've got a long way to go in these categories. I better up the pace. So we're moving on to most epic. By epic, what do we mean? Well, I guess we could mean like just, you know, everything's huge. Like I'm
huge.
Epic.
Huge.
That's
Nick. Nick and Trump. Yeah, that's it. Get rid of the rest of the list, right?
Yeah. So we get... We got two oldies, one middle-aged and one, well, I don't know. Caledon Brood, they've been around for a while too, I guess.
Caledon Brood, is that a reference to Dune?
No, not in this instance.
That'd be Caliban.
So Caledon Brood, Saxon Sabaton, my new favorites, thanks to Pope. And Manowar.
Yeah, that's a cool band. I got introduced it by my stepson, of all people. Yeah.
Yeah, and these are bands that think big. And they do big sweeping things, usually with involving swords or airplanes. And
put a Romans. Blind Guardian on the list.
They're well, on Blind the list Guardian are a different category.
They're coming up later, though.
Okay.
I'm trying to spread the goodness around, but yes, they could go on here very easily. So
I know that you'll consider this like the first album's not cheesy metal, but Motley Crue had some pretty big shows with the. Drum set,
yeah, they did a good show. They put on a good show, I would say. I think you're right there. I think
Meat and Ice Cream.
You mean like that?
Molly Crew haven't really been a band since like the late 90s because what plays nowadays as Motley Crew is that just a shell of their former selves. It's Vince Neil and his Big Max, and
I'd say they're more like Cruel Motley.
Yeah, early Crew is what matters. But
yeah, my favorite song they ever did was Too Young to Fall in Love. That song was just awesome.
Man, that song. Yes.
Well, I'll tell you what, next week we're doing a show on California, LA, the Bay Area, all those stuff. Go. We'll talk about them then for sure.
Mm-hmm.
Big one. That'll be a big show. Say,
they're definitely going to be prominent in that show.
I'd like to say there's going to be an extremely good special guest appearing who has said he can make it next week. And he's a guy that does a lot of stuff on a Friday, usually late on. But anyway, that's...
Man, it's like
there a specific
give it away.
Theme with the area, like with music?
Next week?
Yeah.
So we'll do a show next week, and it will be California, LA, and the Bay Area. It's a California scene. So hair metal bands, punk bands, right up to the present day, and all the good shit, the speed and thrash.
I'll have to talk to you before then.
You will?
Oh, man.
How far back do you want to start it, man? I mean, do you want to talk about the Doors?
I'm about to do a two-parter.
The Doors started in that LA scene, too.
I'm not going to do the 60s and...
Yeah, well, that's what I was going to say. If it's leaning more towards metal,
Van Halen
70s,
onwards,
right?
Basically. Yeah. Sunset Strip scene and then...
yeah,
the Bay Area scene with Metallica and everything. It's going to be more like late 70s onwards.
Got it.
Well, if you go to the Bay Area, very early 80s, is that band Fang, who a lot of bands covered, like Nirvana covered them, Metallica covered them. That's the band that I filled in on bass in 2005.
Well,
so
we'll
I'm going to have to talk to you
clips.
Before then.
We'll play yeah. that clip.
Was an Airplane and Starship from there too?
Yep. But yeah. I've seen Courtney. I've seen you in that clip. And if I was to say the words blonde bombshell, I wouldn't be too far out. So
what can I say?
You had me at the fact you were playing the bass. That's what really did it for me. So Caladan Brood, I don't think there is any photographs of them or indeed videos.
I don't think so. I think this is the only thing they've ever really put out.
So yeah, so this is the imagery on their album though, and it's very sweeping, symphonic.
A cool cover.
Very fellowship induced. That's what I'm saying.
There's a lot of that in there too. And we'll play a little bit of the music from this. Most of the songs are pretty lengthy, so we'll just do a little clip. They're definitely have an epic canvas that they're working with, both sonically and lyrically. Saxon. This is Saxon Charbino, not the Saxon we're looking for, but I still thought I would include her anyway.
I appreciate it.
And you should, as much as possible. Yeah.
So when I talked about Saxon, this is what I really meant. The other Saxon. Not quite as good looking, but, you know. And definitely, for me, just partly because of the subject matter of the songs, Crusader, songs like that,
The Pilgrimage off the new one.
Yeah, the new one is, new album is brilliant. It's all very epic in scale. And the music is they're one of the genuine greats, and they're still with us, which is great. You know, I'm glad they're still with us.
And they still sound great. They don't sound like a band that's like resting on their laurels. Like when you see them live, which is what I did for my first time a few years ago, they are doing a tour when Judas Priest is touring off their Firepower album. Judas Priest, for some reason, was not playing Chicago. So Saxon did a headlining off date from that tour separately, and they chose Reggie's in Chicago. And they did like 20 or 22 songs. And dude, it was absolutely insane. And at the time, I think there was the newest album at the time from Saxon. It was a
Crusader? That was about 10 years ago or more?
Give me a few seconds. I've got to remember the. I can't. Why is it not coming? Thunderbolt. They're tuning off Thunderbolt.
That was a hell of a record, too.
It was a great record. And they did like three or four songs off the album and then a whole bunch of hits. And trust me, you know this, Denim and Leather, all the obvious songs. But it was cool to see them play both and do it shamelessly and effortlessly.
Is epic in scale. I mean, it's all the subject matter I like. You know, it's all medieval stuff, First World War, Crusaders, you name it. It's all in there. I like that. That lyrical epic style.
And I'm pretty sure they were one of the inspirations, along with Iron Maiden, for the other band on this list, Sabaton, because it's a very similar musical style.
Yes, I think Sabaton is being very, very Saxon. Manowar, I mean, there's something very epic about that, obviously.
Hail and Kill might just be the most motivating song of all goddamn time.
Yeah, Manowar, and of course, Sabaton. Who are just, I find it hard to categorize them. I mean, they're traditional, new wave of traditional heavy metal. They're also got that epic, historically epic themes that they have.
Currently, they're kind of like the face of power metal.
Yes.
In the modern era. And they're not a newer band. They've been around since 1999.
They've been around for a while.
And the thing I also like about them is they're actually so goddamned upbeat, which is very unusual in any musical style now.
Especially when you're covering military history and, like, you know, all the horrors of war and stuff like that. It's hard to be like that, but they are.
Yeah, but they're great to their fans on stage.
They are. I've seen these guys live four times. They're fantastic.
Yeah, very positive bunch of guys, so I like that. So we're going to... And there may well be many other epic acts. These are just four that we've decided to focus on in this slide.
When you said epic, the first thing that came in my mind, and they're not... course, you know, I listen to every genre of music just about. Yeah. And, they're not quite metal, but I thought of Queensryche because, you know, they try and tell stories with a lot of their music and stuff like that. That's
yeah,
what
and we could have had them. We could have had Iron Maiden. There's a number of acts who would fit into this very well. So just a little bit of...
Unleash the Archers is another newer one that I would say definitely fits.
So just a little bit of... we'll start with Sabaton. My current favorite song. I don't know. Again, I don't know how much of this we'll get away with. I'll skip past the... I love this set.
Is that a biplane piano?
Yes.
Am I seeing that
it's
right?
It's a biplane with a keyboard on it.
And he is actually the keyboard player on their albums. He's actually the one who's playing it.
Yeah. So let's get to the music. It's... it just... I love this shit. It's just
yeah,
me.
Yeah,
they're
good,
it.
Man. They're good.
It's very prog sounding.
Oh, yeah, this part is, yeah. But just the fact he's dressed in the right gear. This is the Red Baron. And I love the sort of the tank, front of the tank.
Yeah, I noticed that when he had a clip of him earlier and I saw that, yeah.
And it's not like a celebration of war. They're celebrating the heroism of the troops and... No, I'd freely admit I'm not fully up to speed with every current band, but to me this is the best current metal band around of any style.
There's a couple I like better, but they're right up there with I'd say probably top 10 of all time.
Yeah, I'm so glad you introduced me to them, mate. Now I've gone back and got all these albums to listen to.
I was the same way. I came in on the Last Stand album, and within a week I owned like every album they'd done to that point. Yeah. And everyone since I've bought on the day it came out.
Yeah, I got them all. Nick, I just got to listen to them.
Oh, bye, Nick.
Yeah. Oh, Nick, you going?
Nick decided to slip out quietly. He had to go. But thanks for joining us, Nick.
Well,
always
thanks,
a pleasure.
Buddy. Cheers, mate. Yeah, thanks for being
and
here.
And Papa Cotton had an epic joke.
Good there. To see you, man.
Oh.
That was hilarious.
Where's his epic joke? So.
He said, who's more epic than Faith No More?
Oh, right, yeah.
Yeah, I didn't even think about them. Yeah,
the song Epic.
Yeah.
Epic is Maiden are epic. There's no doubt about it. Would not dispute that. But yeah, so that's Sabaton. Who else was on this little list? See if we can get away with playing. We're talking most epic. We have. Let's do Manowar. Yes. I'll flip forward. Warriors of the World United.
And just their lyric, their song titles too, like Hail and Kill, Battle Hymn, Fighting the World. Like,
yeah, they're anthemic.
Oh, yeah.
I have a ridiculous,
they even
I
get
like
chicks
this band
in their
more
games.
Than I should.
That's how Sorry, everyone Gordon. Is with this band.
You like them more than you should, yeah.
Yeah.
Look at the...
You got hit by somebody.
Someone's hit us. Yeah. Policy violations. It'll come back. I just we'll not play so many videos.
Yeah, I think we got nailed for that. I'm just gonna take a quick bathroom break while we go through that.
It's good timing.
Indeed. Yeah. So I'll probably have to cut the video, please.
I'm typing it in chat now.
Yeah. Well, I just pulled
typing
my...
too. I'm going to be right back.
I keep the stream open on my phone so that my computer doesn't reboot. And
thanks,
yeah. I saw it. It just, like right when I said that, it had just gone.
I got the chat open in YouTube, but I've got the other screen overlap. I've only got one screen. My wife got me another monitor because I found out the monitor I bought for this computer, it's like twice as long on the bottom.
We're
top.
Coming back.
so I can't share things off of it.
We're back. Sorry about that, everybody. I guess I was trying to get away with these video plays, and it wasn't going to happen. I guess eventually somebody was going to get me. It's probably bloody Saxon that did it. That's it. I'm burning this t-shirt tonight.
Eight people waited it out.
Either that or Man of War, because the Man of War was right before.
Thanks for waiting out, everybody. We'll probably not play so many videos then and just stick to the images, but yeah, that was the epic bands. And again, there's 10, I mean, there's so much stuff we can have, but we didn't have Maiden in there and various other bands.
You can play the videos with no sound, can't you?
You can.
Or would that hit you?
It's like having a diet drink, isn't it? Or a non-alcoholic beer.
You're
or
right.
Decaffeinated coffee.
I can always say,
oh God. Okay. Yeah. Forget I said anything. God.
Could have been Man of War. Yeah, we'll just show some images, but so that was in the epic category. I mean, as I say, I love Sabaton now, and thanks to Pope for introducing me to them. And
the funny thing is, have you heard the song Bismarck?
Yes. Oh yeah, I like the video.
Did that intro riff sound familiar to you at all?
I can't remember now, but it probably did. But
if you want it like blatantly obvious, play The Hellion by Judas Priest and then play Bismarck.
Wow, really?
Yep. Play them one after the other. It's blatant.
Well, there's nothing new under the sun, is there?
Well, no, and they did embellish it and really kind of make it their own. But especially being the huge Priest fan and Screaming for Vengeance fan like I am, I'm like, wait a minute, I've heard this before somewhere. It took me a couple of tries to get where it was from.
I'm definitely going to vote for Saxon as the most epic in that category. So congratulations, Saxon.
I can't deny that one.
Yep.
No, I'm not showing it. Sorry. There we go. So congratulations to Saxon for winning that.
That is certainly epic. And she wins in many, many categories.
On several levels.
I don't know who she is, but she's pretty hot. Saxon Charbino.
This is what's great about Google image searches. Sometimes you get pleasant surprises, and sometimes they're not so pleasant.
Yeah, so we're gonna go through.
Oh, have you googled Blue Waffle?
Oh, please don't.
No,
you should look.
Come on, bro. Thanks just for like, the visual.
Just like, come on, man.
Right. It's burned in there. You know,
we're gonna tackle a controversial subject: worst album.
Oh boy!
Some of these are bad albums by good bands.
Yeah.
Some are just bad.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Wow.
There's a lot of real stinkers on here.
This was the proposed list from the panel.
This is a whole show in itself.
Mm-hmm. It is.
Of just deriding these albums.
Wait.
The last one is my favorite.
Wait. It took the worst album category for us to finally mention Megadeth? Really? Wow.
Yes.
I was waiting for Megadeth's name to come up, and here it is in worst album.
I played them in the opening montage. They got a note. They got a note. Right. So, Celtic Frost.
We're actually going to be doing them this weekend.
Cherry Orchard.
So.
With the song Cherry Orchard on the album Cold Lake. Apparently, it's really bad.
Oh, yeah.
But were they ever really good? It would be my question.
Yeah, they were fantastic. Oh, yeah. They were a seminal influence in black metal.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
They don't look very black metal.
No.
By this point, they were not.
They are the definition of the higher the hair, the closer to God.
They look like they can't figure out if they want to be Cinderella or Van Halen.
Or Bon Jovi.
Cinder Halen.
But Celtic Frost started in the late 70s, early 80s as a band named Hellhammer.
Yep. Oh, Hellhammer, yeah.
And then went on to form Celtic Frost. They're most of the same members, anyway.
Was this just a commercial grab for money?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And everyone hates them for it because they should.
And I did listen to Cherry Orchard, and I can't play it now.
Oh, God's killing it, man.
I call Butt Rock too.
Oh yeah.
I love Butt Rock.
Thanks, mate. Butt Rock, yeah. Butt and, Rock. And I did watch the video for Cherry Orchard, and it was a bit.
I am a fan of their early output, and I think that just makes me hate this stuff even more.
Yeah, I think my gender fluid started rising and pouring out of me and dripping onto the floor with Cherry Orchard.
I've never seen them look like this before. I'm not familiar with Cold Lake.
Yeah.
But I mean, they're a good band. They're a very influential band.
They were.
It's like the Bathory of Switzerland, in a way.
The Bathory of Switzerland, yeah. So we'll move. And they were Swiss, which explains a lot. Isn't that where Europe were from? Iron Maiden, Virtual 11. Now,
even the album art is bad.
Yeah. And the logo's been changed a bit, and I mean, to be fair, it was the second album with what's the singer's name?
Blaze Bailey.
Yeah, Blaze Bailey.
The worst singer Iron Maiden has ever even talked to.
Yeah. And yeah. I listened to it once. I didn't buy it. I listened to it once and I went, nah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, when I was first getting into Iron Maiden, I was like 19 or 20. I was listening to whole discographies, right? And so I was going through all of Iron Maiden. I got to this one. I'm like, ugh, I just kind of skip to the next album.
Why?
The good news is the next album is Brave New World, and that kicks ass.
Yeah.
Now, I do like The Clansman, which is on here. That's an okay song, but the rest are a bit...
It's only okay when Bruce Dickinson sings it.
Yes, and they re-recorded it with him singing, and it is still in their set sometimes. So it's. I don't know if they do any other songs from this album in their set.
Ever. But I don't know who at their management decided to replace a singer with a 5-octave range with a singer with a very low 2-octave range. But they should fire that person.
And let him write some songs.
Yeah, that was even worse. Now, I'm not shitting on Blaze Bailey as a singer. With other bands, he's fine. But with Maiden, no.
No.
Yeah, I was just going to say, how's he... I wonder what Run to the Hills sounded like with him singing that.
Absolutely god awful.
Yeah, no. You could probably find it, but don't. They needed their own Ripper Owens, you know, like Judas Priest.
Probably sounds
you know?
Like Nikki... Vince
Neil. You know, people rip on the Priest albums that have Ripper on them. But they're actually pretty good, and the bad parts about them have nothing to do with him.
Yeah, no, he's great, because I first remember him being in Ice Earth, and I'm like, this guy's awesome, and then I found out later, like, oh, that was the guy that filled in on Priest when Halford wasn't in the band. No, he's a great singer. And, of course, he can sing Halford's parts because he was in a cover band.
Yep. In fact, the movie Rockstar is loosely based on that story.
Right.
I just and think
not that, on yeah. Blaze Bailey.
No.
I think some of the songs really just the style just wasn't right. You know what I mean? They didn't sound like Maiden.
Throughout the 90s, they hadn't really sounded like Maiden. I mean, Fear of the Dark, the title track's about the only good thing on that record.
Mm. You're not wrong.
And then. After that, until Brave New World, it just all sucks.
Yeah, it just there was no energy in it. I think is what I would. I don't know how to describe it. It didn't. It sounded flat. It didn't sound like there was any energy. And I don't know whether that was the band or the production or the songs. But
I think it might have been both.
There was a lot of smoke, but there was no thunder or fire. You know, so disappointing. I mean, it's not to suggest they're not one of the greatest bands of all time, but it's just everybody has a stinker, and that was theirs.
Yeah.
Metallica,
Stanger. This album never happened. It was a massive hallucination, and we should all stop pretending it did.
This picture means nothing. I don't know what it is. Did somebody make this up?
Oh, yeah, that art is by Pusshead. But I remember when St. Anger came out because it was right when I was in high school really, really getting into Metallica. And then this came out, and I'm like, I was so excited. And then I heard it. Yeah. I'm like, what the?
And then you stop being into Metallica.
Yeah. And again, what were they trying to do? I mean,
kind of like capture raw emotion.
It's kind of like listening to Dynasty by Kiss, right? What the hell is this?
But I mean,
no
solos, no guitar solos.
Nope. And like, Lars literally took the snare off of his snare drum.
Yeah.
Because he forgot to put it on one day.
I get it. The bands want to try different things. I mean, that's not. But just.
You know. They already hadn't been great throughout the 90s, and then this came out, and most fans were like, you know what? We're out.
I mean, I actually don't mind doing a raw sounding album, but the songs weren't good anyway. I mean,
but they had already done that with their early stuff, and it sounded way better.
That's right. And they're so repetitive. So. The songs were so long and just. Without any like change in time signatures, no any solos, any
and
bridges.
That's something they're famous for is that time signature changes and variations in the rhythm.
Yeah.
There's
none of that in here. None of that.
It was just like we were contractually obligated to put out an album, so here we crapped it out in 5 minutes. Yeah. Here you go.
So not that good.
Mm-hmm. They did have to take a break while James went to rehab, and when he got out, he could only record with them from noon to 4 p.m. for a while. So they did kind of have to be quick, yeah. And they did a lot of stuff without like what do you call it when you produce and you like tweak things. They did without a lot of tweaking
production.
Sure,
they just little production. Yeah, like you know when you take it and then you tweak it to make it sound right. They deliberately didn't do that, and they used a lot of like first takes. They just wanted to capture the raw emotion.
You're talking about post production editing, yeah.
Yeah.
Kind of, but more about like polishing. That was because I was actually reading about their whole discography over the weekend, and just for fun. And when I was reading about this one, it's like, yeah, they deliberately didn't polish it, right? So they produced it, but they didn't polish anything. You know, where you like make it sound a little bit better than it really did. Yeah.
Yeah, it's funny because a lot of critics at the time actually quite liked it, but I really don't think it's. I mean, there's no memorable songs.
They liked
songs.
It because Metallica's label paid them to.
Yeah. Anyway, it's like the Highlander 2 of albums. So.
Yeah. Well, I do appreciate that Metallica is not like George Lucas about their catalog, where they realize they've made mistakes and they made bad decisions, but they don't want to go back and change anything because it was the way it was at the time, and that's what gives it character, even if it was bad. So they're like, yeah, you know, we don't hate this album. We know a lot of people do. We wouldn't change it though because, you know, it was honest at the time.
Oh, you're hurting my heart.
So we're moving on. We're moving on. One of our beloved bands that we all adore.
Now I'm surprised you picked this one. There's a much worse one from later.
What, Ram It Down?
Well, yeah. I think the reason I picked this one is because it's a little bit electro. There's a little bit too much.
You didn't like Nostradamus?
Nostradamus is terrible.
Oh no!
This album's actually listenable. I actually do like some stuff on this. Private Property's got a pretty good riff in there.
There's a couple of good songs in it, but it's just not very priesty, I don't think.
As an album, it definitely did not fit their motif.
I think it suffers because it came right after Screaming for Vengeance and Defenders of the Faith.
It did. And again, I'm not faulting them for wanting to try to do something different, but they just went a little bit too commercial, a little bit too light, too many keyboards and synths.
But that was 86. Everyone was doing that. I know. Iron Maiden did it with Somewhere in Time, all of it.
I don't mind Turbo Lover and Locked In. They're quite good songs, but the rest I could probably live without.
Private Property's pretty good. I like it.
You see this comment? Southern Viking said, I was thinking that Load and Reload are the Highlander 2 of albums.
Sorry. Yeah. We dare not speak its name.
We dare not speak their names. But anyway, not that we don't love Priest, and they're definitely in the goat category later that we're talking about. But I think they were a little bit drug and there were some drug problems. There were some drink problems.
They jumped the shark on this one a little.
The
bit.
Writing wasn't great. I don't think their heart was in it. Great band. Great bands have to have a bad album somewhere.
Well, I don't think it's a bad record. I think it came out at a weird time for them, and due to the incredible heights that they'd hit before this, it looks bad by comparison. Same thing with Point of Entry, where it's sandwiched in between British Steel and Screaming for Vengeance, so of course it looks kind of bad by comparison.
But it's a great album. That's the one that I dig. So,
And it was the wrong direction for this time, right? Because rock and heavy metal, people were starting to get tired of like hair metal, and you started getting like the sleazier bands like Guns N' Roses,
you're starting to get into grunge. that dirtier, more hard rock sound, yeah,
right. And then in the underground, you had death metal growing, and so they did this, then Ram It Down, and then Painkiller, and that was the right choice at the right time.
Well, Ram It Down and Painkiller are two Ram It Down has its high points, but it still needs some work. And then Painkiller, they absolutely locked in and fired.
Painkiller is massive. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Anyway, no, not knocking Priest. We all love them, but so with Megadeth finally get a look in,
not the way we wanted them to.
No. Quite the way we wanted them to. This is more. These are disappointing, not necessarily the worst albums. The worst albums in the world are done by crappy bands. These are great bands, but they're disappointing albums. I guess
we're not mad. We're just disappointed.
Yeah, the worst albums that we were willing to listen to because they were by good bands.
Fair.
You know, the first exposure I got to Megadeth was the Last Action Hero soundtrack. They did that song Angry Again.
Oh, yeah.
I just thought that it blew me away when I heard it in the theater. I was like, man, I got to find out who these guys are.
Yeah, and indeed, and there's some fantastic albums in there. They are one of the big four for a reason.
We used to love trolling the Airborne guys whenever we would interact, because we would just put High Speed Dirt on the jukebox and then watch their reaction.
Yeah,
that's good.
So I just think it's a bit, it's too smooth, it's too flashy. Crush 'em, for instance, is
doesn't sound like Megadeth.
There's nothing crushing about it. It doesn't crush me.
It doesn't Megadeth.
Yeah, yeah, I mean, it was in Universal Soldier, The Return. I mean, come on. But it's more, it's 80s. Wasn't it the 90s?
Was it 90s.
But it's still got that 80s smooth thing going on, like smooth pop, shiny.
Which is funny, because their 80s stuff didn't have that.
No.
Right.
It's like they waited a long time to get to that.
Right. Like he stopped doing cocaine or something.
It's cheesy, I would say.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
is it worse than Super Collider?
I would say possibly just yes, but
it's close.
One thing albums have in common is that it's bands veering them away from what they do the best.
Yeah.
And
I get it. They want to do something different, but you don't have to ditch everything that you are. You know.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
However, it's not to say they didn't do stuff that we love, because they did. But anyway, so the last one wasn't so much an album, but just an entire oeuvre, Limp Bizkit. Anything by Limp Bizkit is in the worst of all time category, in my opinion.
Having been a child in the 90s and having to hear these guys constantly, that entire band was just a mistake.
I just can't, it's just me, and others may love them. I can't stand that new metal.
I like some of it, like Disturbed and Slipknot are pretty okay, but
Disturbed is a different beast, I think, to these guys.
Oh yeah, these guys are just horrible.
Yeah.
Yeah. No band ever consider themselves new metal.
No.
If you ask
them. No.
Right. Limp Bizkit in particular, I remember I think it was like 11, and so I wasn't listening to current music yet.
11?
I mean, like a 14-year-old kid was like, "Hey, do you like Limp Bizkit?" And I was like, 11. I'm like, "What kind of biscuit?" And he put it on, and I was like, "Eh." And then so like, you know, I went through middle school and high school hearing it. And I think I just got used to it, and I learned to, you know, endure it. But I really liked it. So there was never really a point where it was considered good music.
Yeah, and Soul Assassin's got some good, you know, bands there that are, I mean, they're not necessarily in my favorite bands, but I can listen to them. Whereas Limp Bizkit, I would not just turn the radio off, I would throw it out of the top floor window of the apartment.
Me too, I'm with you on that. I cannot stand anything.
Yeah, nothing.
They're as bad as Creed to me.
Yeah.
Or Nickelback.
I'm with you, Courtney. I'm with you. So album
the N-word just came out. Look out! Oh, man.
Every one of their albums is on the worst album of all time list. I don't know what anybody else in the chat thinks. Like, if we've got albums we may have missed, particularly by good bands that are we expect better of. But
I would put almost. I mean, in addition to Virtual 11, I'd put almost everything Iron Maiden has done since Brave New World on that list.
Yeah, I know, and they've been pretty patchy at times, which is.
And like I said, Priest Nostradamus was far worse than Turbo Cut.
Oh,
can I comment?
So much hate for Nostradamus.
I liked it, but I felt they were trying too hard.
It's not a Priest record.
No, I feel they're trying awfully hard to be very modern.
It's very power metal.
Yeah, it's power metal. Yeah. However, what was my next category? See, I'm racing through these because I got a hard stop at the top of the hour. And now that we're, I can't, oh, she's still there.
Yes, she's still
She can stay there. So
the rest of you leave.
You get no argument here.
We're getting close to the end of so this one's an interesting one. I was kind of hoping our friend Salty Texas C would join. I think he was in the chat earlier, but he works on Mondays and it's hard for him to get here. But This is one Tolkien over the line.
One Tolkien over the line.
Over the line. And for those who know the old one Tolk over the line, that's a joke. Yes.
Oh, this is what you were saving one. Black Guardian for.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, we were saving Black Guardian for. So we have bands that are particularly Tolkienized. And I have actually an image I wanted to show. Oh, yeah. So here it is. So let's get to the. Let's start with the old boys, Led Zeppelin. So here they are actually appearing with J.R.R. Tolkien back in the day.
Yeah.
Yeah, so not a lot of people have seen this. It's an obscure clip from the 60s, but they did an entire gig with him.
It looks like Paul Chatto dressed as J.R.R. Tolkien.
But as we all know, the Zeppelin were extremely Tolkien-esque, Battle of Evermore, various other tracks. And they were into that. And so they should be, because they were all into English and British folklore, and so it's particularly Robert Plant, and a lot of that stuff explicitly was in their music. So I think Zeppelin are very Tolkien inspired, as were many other non-metal bands. I mean, Genesis, awful lot of Tolkien in their work.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you could probably reel off tens of hundreds of bands, if not, that were into them. But just to get more metally, I guess, though.
I mean, there's a ton of metal bands that like either get their name or their song titles from Tolkien directly.
Oh, like, absolutely. Yeah.
Bands like Numenorian and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Or Amon Amarth.
Oh, yeah. So yeah. A lot of like black metal bands that have either band names or their own pseudonyms named after stuff from Tolkien.
Yep.
Yeah. And Summoning do an awful lot of explicitly Tolkien albums.
And have been since the mid-90s.
Yeah, yep. I mean, they're actual concept albums based upon the works of Tolkien. So they're very in that. And it's the only reason we kind of wanted to have this in here is because of all the controversy over the non-Tolkien power, Rings of Power.
I was going to say, that show's in so much trouble when it comes out.
Oh, that show is heresy. Heresy.
Yeah, here's people who actually love Tolkien, and they're making music based on it.
Tiny little Austrian two-man band.
Yeah, go out and get this stuff, guys. Don't even give that your attention.
Yeah, and I don't think these guys, they don't play live, I don't think.
No, their other band doesn't play live either, Abigor.
Yeah, but they've done a series of albums that are, and you introduced them to me, I think, Imperatus, and I'm really getting into these now.
Yeah, they're not your typical metal either. They're not very fast. They're not exactly even really that heavy, but they have their own unique sound. I mean, the vocal style is still very much so in the black metal format of things.
Yeah, it's like melodic black metal, which is an interesting concept.
They also, one of their albums, they use samples from the BBC reading of Lord of the Rings.
Oh, that's nice.
Wow.
Yeah. Is it Austrian? They're Austrian,
Yeah, they're Austrian.
Yeah, so they're very into Tolkien, which is, I'm trying to get into these guys a lot more, listening to it when I get the
chance. Fantastic.
They're great if you got to take long drives. Same with Caladan Brood.
Yep.
Yeah.
Hey, I know them.
Nightwish.
Yeah.
Actually related to another band that we've talked about. Their Sabaton's drummer is married to to Floor Jensen.
Oh, yeah. So Floor is with them now. I remember when I first got into them, Taria was still their singer, and then she left and or got kicked out. And then they
wasn't she?
It depends on who you ask.
Yeah. Kind of. Well, you could tell on the album once that the songwriter was like deeply in love with her, but it was like a forbidden love because she was married, and it comes through in all the lyrics, you know. But it made the album really good because of that, you know, that frustrated passion. But then, then she was gone.
They waited till they finished the concert, though, before to make the live album before they sacked her. It's just, okay, thanks for the gig. Now, fuck off.
Well, they were together for like five albums by that point.
I know. But I would describe these guys as very symphonic
metal. Well, they're the epitome of symphonic metal. And unfortunately, symphonic metal also has a habit for firing their female singers when they start getting older.
Oh, right. Okay. Well, they can just get them married off to the drummers in other bands.
Or, well, that's true. Yeah.
If I didn't know any better, the guy second from the right there, he looks just like Chris Jericho, who's got his own rock band.
Ozzy.
Yeah.
He does.
Yeah. He does look he just does, like him. Yeah. My God, he could be his twin brother.
And I'm pretty sure that's Rick Wakeman's son in the middle, the blonde.
Oh, that's Marco Hietala. He's the Frozen Viking. That used to be his internet name, Frozen Viking.
Oh, right, yeah. It just looks like Rick Wakeman.
Reminds me of one of my girlfriends who's a dominatrix.
He looks like a metal version of Edgar Winter.
He does, actually. I've seen Edgar Winter live a few times. He's really good. He's good fun.
Now, this guy's actually a really good vocalist. His lower range complements the female voice really well. He's a vocalist / bassist, of which we've seen many.
Oh, yeah. But I've seen Johnny Winter a few times, too, but he didn't end up so well. Poor bugger. But, yes, these guys have had quite a bit of commercial success as well.
Oh, yeah. These guys are huge.
Yeah, so I'm really trying to get into them, and they've got an awful lot of Tolkien influences in there too, which is beautiful. And then Blind Guardian, at last, Blind Guardian.
Wow, yes. Check that out, man.
And they did an entire album, Twilight and Middle Earth, which is absolutely fantastic.
Yeah, again, I'm just getting turned on to this stuff now.
Including my favorite song from them, Full Stop and Mirror, Mirror.
Oh, yeah.
They're German band, power metal, but again, with symphonic and progressive, a lot more progressive, I'd say, than power these days. There's a very progressive band, metal.
That came in a lot later. These guys.
Could this be nerd metal?
This is power, straight 80s style power metal. Like, these guys came out about the same time as like Gamma Ray and Manowar.
Yeah. Yeah, and Halloween.
Yeah,
and it's very fantasy influenced power metal.
Yeah,
and I don't think they tour the U.S. very often. So when I got to see them, it was a real treat.
Yeah, and I think isn't there a thing that they say there's the we have the big four from the 80s and 90s, and they've got the big four power metal bands, which is Blind Guardian, Halloween, Sabaton, and Dragon Force. So they're
I wouldn't include Dragon Force in there.
Yeah, well, Dragon Force is not really old enough.
And neither Sabaton really. I'd put Rainbow and Gamma Ray in there.
Okay. What about Stradivarius?
They're later, but they're absolutely fantastic.
Yeah, so they do have a lot of direct Tolkien influences in the albums.
Oh yeah,
lyrics, titles, themes. So it's they're very much inspired by that. Again, you guys have Pope. You introduced me to these guys and Imperatus, and I'm getting into them too. And it's stuff I didn't know about and appreciate, and I love it.
I'm hearing a bunch of stuff that I'd never heard of, and it looks pretty cool. I'm definitely going to be investigating.
That is a phenomenal piece of album art there.
If you guys want recommendations, let me know. I got plenty of them.
As do I.
And I think that's what they look like.
Yep,
this is an older one, yeah, because Hansi's got short hair now.
Yeah, but you know, you kind of think you're going to see guys that look like wizards or all dressed up in whatever. No, just ordinary guys.
They look like they're working class dogs, as Rick Springfield once said, working class dogs.
Courtney,
this photo looks like when I finally got to see Flock of Seagulls in the 90s. This is what they look like by then.
This is a flock of eagles. A flock of eagles.
Yeah.
This is like, it looks like the cover band I saw in downtown in the park the other day. But, so that's the Tolkien. I mean, there's a ton of Tolkien inspired stuff, but these are the guys that are really leading it, I think. And it's great. It's lovely. They're paying tribute to fantastic literature and old tales, old lore, which I love. Oh, Saxon is still there.
There's the big hair in the butt rock.
Yeah. Now, did you see my mention of Rhapsody of Fire? They're not specifically Tolkien related, but they're very fantasy oriented, and they have their own like mythos that is internal to their discography. But it's like one continuous story, you know, from album to album.
Yeah, fantasy has always played a large part in metal and progressive rock.
Pretty much from Rainbow and Rush on up.
Yeah, all based upon European and Northern European lore, folklore, Eldish, English folklore, Celtic folklore. It's a huge part of it. And I think that long may that continue and not be driven out of culture.
And for the Scandinavians, the Kalevala.
Oh, yeah.
Particularly the Finnish.
Yeah. So we're getting close to the end. Close to the edge.
Oh.
And this is one I did. I deliberately did not put anything in here. It's the age-old problem of if you're forced to go to a desert island and take one metal album with you. Hell, one album with you, what would you take? Who would it be? Can it even be done to narrow it down to such a thing?
I got a feeling me and Pope are going to have the same one.
It's like picking your favorite kid, but I've already done. Yeah. Everyone knows what my favorite record is.
I was fixing to say, and I was on the show when we were talking about it.
ABBA's Waterloo.
Yeah, of course. He nailed it in one.
That's it.
No, I got to go. Judas Priest, Screaming for Vengeance, hands down.
Yeah.
And I'm with him on that one. Yep.
I see. Courtney, my dear, what would you, if you were
I'm
forced
trying.
To... Point of death to pick one album. It doesn't even have to be metal. What would it be?
It doesn't have to be metal.
Nope.
I was going to say, if it doesn't have to be metal, I'm changing my
finger. Inflammable Material.
Okay, cool. Good band. Made my ears bleed.
I just saw them. They were the last live show that I have seen and probably will see in a very long time.
Oh, wow.
I saw them right before. Everything
with me. Yeah. I mean, I did want to stick to metal bands, but you know, if someone doesn't want to pick
but
a
metal
band,
wise,
that's up to them.
I mean, you guys, any Motorhead probably, but yeah. Honestly and truly, the first Motley Crue album, and you can make fun of me all you want.
Would not it's do that stuff. At all, Lass. Would
it's
not
so
make
good.
Fun of you at all. That's a
cool. I mean, I have
cool
Livewire
choice.
Tattooed on me, like a large, you know, you guys have seen it.
So Das Wolfen's got Metallica, Master of Puppets. Southern Viking is tormented and can't choose, and he's right. It's tough to choose.
Yeah.
Our good friend and panelist in the past, and will be again in the future for sure, Legalize Adulthood, that Live at Leeds by The Who. Now, that's certainly one of my favorite albums of all time.
Now, do we want to separate out live albums from the studio ones?
You can, if you want to live album.
Live, I'd have to choose between two Motorhead records. Either No Sleep Till Hammersmith, or I think is a little bit better, might be Stage Fright.
Okay, cool.
I think the first one's better, but they're both great. Good pick.
Papa Cotton's picking Tool, Undertow.
Another great one.
I'm not a Tool.
You're not enough of a stoner, Courtney.
I love stoner rock. I've seen Tool. I just never got into the, I don't know, never.
I am, like you all, I am conflicted, and it does change from time to time. But I, if forced to pick, I would pick British Steel, Judas Priest.
There you go.
That's my favorite metal album.
A lot
album
of Priest
of
in
time.
There.
Yeah, and I would have to go with Painkiller.
There you go.
There you go. Yeah.
Isn't that interesting?
If I got to pick anything... Though yeah. It would be Foreigner's self-titled album. That they're my favorite
first
band
one.
Ever.
Yep. Yeah.
Yep.
I'm a big Foreigner fan. I probably would have probably gone for Four though if I was going to pick one.
Nah. Feels
I
like
know
the
it's
first
poppy.
Time. Best song ever.
I know it's best poppy, but you know. Well, we could have a whole stream about that, my friend.
You
we
know
probably
it.
Will one day.
Yep.
Imperatus, have we heard from you? I can't.
For me, yeah, definitely kind of a little hard, but. One, two choices for me. One would probably be Slayer, Rain and Blood.
Yep.
That's
good choice.
Pick. That's a really good pick, yeah.
And the other, I don't know if you would consider this an album, but one of the first two Blackened compilations.
That's so okay.
Nice. Because there were two disc compilations that really turned me on to a lot of the second wave of black metal. And, you know, it was better to buy a two disc compilation where you knew there were some good tracks on there. And some stuff you wanted to check out than taking a risk on a full album from someone else.
There were a couple of punk compilations that got me into some good stuff. So
compilations can be good, Courtney. Yeah, I mean, they're not
well, and they've launched careers. I mean, that's how Bathory got discovered in 83, which Scandinavian Metal Attack.
Yeah, I mean, if you take a band like Crowded House, they've got a number of really good albums, but for me, it's the greatest hits that they put out, the 20 track best of, which is the cream of the crop for them. I always listen to that one and not the other albums they made, which is wrong, I guess, but it's got all those great songs in it. So it can work, you know, it can be the thing that gets you into it. And if you get the right compilation album that's got extra tracks, live versions, deep cuts on it, it could be even better, you know. So but yeah, I'd pick British Steel. Tomorrow I'll probably think of something different, but it'll be too late by then. And I'm old school, so I would go for the older stuff. But I'd be tempted to have said Van Halen's first album as well.
Yeah, that's
they're gonna say Slade.
Dynamite stuff.
Well, Slade did a lot of heavy rock, but they were not a metal band, so I would exclude them from that.
What do you consider them? Just hard rock?
Just hard rock. Yeah, just a hard rock band. They happened to get tagged, unfortunately, as glam, but they weren't really a glam band. Unfortunate fact that Dave Hill, the lead guitarist, did look like a bit of a dork. So,
well, and they were covered by the a glam band. So
exactly. Come on, feel the noise.
Yeah, we're sticking the metal. Yeah, because I mean, there's
sticking the metal.
Yeah, beast. When it comes to rock, there's so many different genres. I mean, I'm sitting here thinking we're talking hair bands. Well, one of the biggest hair bands of the '80s was 38 Special, but they're southern rock. You know,
yeah.
I mean,
yeah, I have seen them live a couple of times as well.
I've seen twice with my brother. Both times we went saw them together, and we never went to concerts together.
And now you'll never speak again.
Yeah. Right.
As a result. Mm-hmm. So best album, tough one, I know. It's just always nice to kind of throw that in there to see what people say. We get Papa Cotton, Lamb of God, Sacrament, excellent choice. Mm-hmm. We have some votes for Celtic Frost though.
Morbid Tales, okay.
Yeah. Good call.
I've already changed my mind like 10 times, so I don't even know.
Yeah, too. That's hard.
Well, Cosmic mentioned AC/DC and If You Want Blood, and I could have picked If You Want Blood too. That's a killer album, live album. But
Megadeth, Rust in Peace.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. I was so in love with Dave Mustaine when I was younger. Still am, I guess.
And live albums, it's not necessarily metal, but it's hard rock. Thin Lizzy's Live and Dangerous would always be in my, right up there in my top 10.
Live at Budokan is a good live.
The extended Budokan with the whole gig, because it's the hit one was like one disc and it's just part of the songs. But yeah, Live at Leeds, The Who is a, and then again, the extended version of that, not the original six song one, the one with everything on it is just fucking killer. That was a band that wasn't metal, but they were loud as fuck. So that was the best album. The last category, and we could have whole streams about that. It'd be nice to finish on that. We're going to go for the GOAT. Greatest of all time. Could be band, could be a singer, could be an album. Greatest of all time. Who's got a GOAT?
I do. Lemmy is God.
So Nick's dad is your goat.
There you go.
I wouldn't say anything bad about Motorhead. They're my number two, right behind who I'm about to mention. But Judas Priest, hands down, the most prolific and greatest, I'd say, rock band ever formed.
Yeah. Cool.
Were we going by band or the person?
Could be anything. Just the GOAT, greatest of all time. Could be a band, could be a singer, could be a musician, could be whatever.
I'll stick with Lemmy for now.
And, you know, I'm looking at more. So Papa Cotton's got Buckethead. So,
guitarist Edward Van Halen.
Yep.
Band, Judas Priest. Singer, Ronnie James Dio.
Agreed 100% on all counts.
I would probably say band, and thinking more of metal or harder rock, I would agree entirely, Joe. I'd say Judas Priest, but I would say Ronnie James Dio as a singer. But if I was to pick a guitarist of any rock category, it would be Stevie Ray Vaughan.
Yeah, that's fair.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I can see that.
Or Rory Gallagher, Irish.
There's so many good ones, man.
Oh, but yeah, metal. Man. When it comes to the metal field, there's so many good ones. Yeah. But Priest, why I think, can't I are.
What's the guy's name from Thin Lizzy again?
Tin Lizzy. Now you're talking Phil Lynott.
The guitarist, right? With the
John double. Sykes.
Oh, Scott Gorham, Brian Robertson.
Gary I don't Moore. Know, but what in fact?
They've had so many. John Sykes was in there for a minute from John Tigers Sykes. Of Pandang.
Eric Bell was the first one. There was yep. Eric Bell, then there was Gary Moore, and then there was Scott Gorham and Brian Robertson were the kind of the mainstays for a number of years, and then they had John Sykes. Midge Ure was even in Thin Lizzy for a while.
Okay, forget that, because I'm not sure.
And Phil Lynott was the bass player and singer. But yeah, well, Queen, I mean, there's a band, they're not metal, but my God, some of the best gigs I've ever seen have been Queen.
So. I think they might go down as the greatest live performers of all time, just for that Wembley stage.
There's a serious argument for best live performer ever, Pope's right about that.
Oh, yeah, just...
Yeah, just as a band, they knew how
absolute
to get
Absolute titans.
Dimebag Darrell, probably, says that's Pope.
If I had a second or third choice after British Steel by Priest, I'd probably say Animal Magnetism by the Scorpions would be
another great one.
Most possibly number two.
Wow.
And then
you got to include Alice Cooper.
Yes, you can.
That and that's another that. Great guitarist is Michael Schenker.
Mm-hmm. Oh, Schenker. And Schenker was in UFO as well. Another one of my favorite bands.
How many people on these lists have been influenced by Alice Cooper?
I mean, almost all.
Yeah, right. I mean, the makeup, the look, everything.
I think 50% of them, by the looks of it. So
King Diamond, 100%. He got his. I mean, not only the look, but also his lyrical content, because his albums are basically a horror story told in the course of an album, which is fantastic.
I love it.
So I think what we'll do one day is we'll just settle on to a conversation for 3 hours about the goats, and we'll pick our favorites in every category we can think of: bassist, singer, drummers, albums, songs. Might not be our favorite band, but maybe one of our.
As soon as you said drummer, the first name that jumped in my mind was Neil Peart.
Neil Peart, and then if I had a number two choice, it would be Cozy Powell.
Cozy Powell, Keith Moon's up there.
Keith Moon.
Well, John Bonham, just because of how hard he hit him. I mean,
Keith Moon is the best Keith Moon style drummer in the world, you know.
Bill Ward from Sabbath.
Oh yeah, I mean, I guess it's great. I mean, we could list them all day, and I think the fun bit is in saying why we think it. So. Yeah. So I am gonna have to draw a line, unfortunately, under today's show. Saxon. Saxon drugs and rock and roll. I would love to, and I'm going to, thank everybody in the chat for being here and sticking it out. We had our interruption in the middle. I've no doubt this stream will not survive because there'll be so many copyright claims in it. I'll have to drop it. But we had fun. So lots of people here, Random Brad Creator, Papa Cotton, thank you, my friend, for your great contributions. Same for you, Das Wolfen. Cosmic, wherever you've gone. There you go. Cosmic, my brother. Always great to be with you, buddy, and hang out with you. Richard, Legalize Adulthood, you will be on the next stream or the one after, whenever, man. You're going to be back, don't worry. We've had Papa Cotton. Brahma Bull, my friend, who nominates Dimebag. And, you know, there's a good case to be made for that as a goat. And Darius is always agreeing. Who else was with us? Southern Viking. Good to see you. Apologies if I miss anyone in this scroll back. There was a lot of people here earlier too. Soul Assassin. Good friend of the channel. Thank you. I really appreciate your being here. And apologies if I missed anybody. Kitty Bear. Yeah, thanks, my friend. Again, another great supporter of these streams. Really appreciate you being here and adding to the fun. And we do it for fun. That's what we do this for. We have great chats and we do it for fun. If I've missed anyone...
I just want to give him a special shout-out.
Sorry, to who?
My buddy Nico.
Oh, Nico, yeah. Yeah, and I may well miss people. I'm scrolling back. So sorry if I've missed anyone. I know there was a bunch of people here earlier. Maybe they, some of them had to drop out for various reasons, but thank them all. I thank you all for being here. Wouldn't be anything without you guys. But now to my gorgeous panel and Pope. It's time for you guys to do some plug-in. So, Imperatus, my friend, thank you for being here, and thank you for all the great music you've turned me on to. What's happening with you, buddy?
Let's see. I actually got a few things coming up this week for once. Tomorrow I'm going to be doing a stream with Doc 2.0, as he's known on Twitter, but he's also known for being on the Comics Aficionado stream Saturday mornings with Wes from Talking Thinking Critical. And we're going to be talking about the glory days of the X-Men.
Oh, there you go.
That should be interesting. He's always a good conversation. Then Thursday, I'll be gaming with Foulball Productions. Remains to be seen what we will be playing this week. Hopefully, it'll be involving less whining from him.
How do you have the stamina to watch him playing that game?
I was focused on doing my own thing. I didn't really. I lost him in the mix. It's like, oh, there's 64 people on this map, and there goes Matt somewhere.
How many deaths did he just go through there?
Oh, we both had upwards of triple digits, I'm sure.
It was fun, though. It was a lot of fun.
And I then like watching him. I forgot you stream with him. That's where I see you about this.
And then Friday, I'll be on, more than likely, depending on how work goes, the MFR Cocktail Lounge on Foulball Productions. And that's always interesting. We had a great conversation this past week about someone's really crappy idea of a list of best sci-fi movies.
Oh, my God. That was horrible. Yeah.
So, that sounds awesome. Highlander 2. Where was Highlander 2 on there?
Not on that list, thankfully. But, yeah, that's what I got going on this week. And other than that, we'll probably get another album review out in the next few days, hopefully.
Cool. Thanks, buddy. Appreciate it.
Oh, anytime.
Pope.
How's it going, guys?
Man with the weirdest camera angle on YouTube.
Yeah, my setup's kind of odd right now. But, so far, I'll probably have another solo album review coming out this week. I've been starting to decided to start doing more of that stuff. Stuff that I don't think needs a whole stream. Or, like, you know, if it's just that album or the band only has one record, then I'll probably do that on that. So I've been trying to do more of that stuff. I just dropped a comic book review for the first time ever on the old Rocketeer compilation. So that was a pretty fun one for me. And then the only thing I got going on is Sunday. I'll be doing Rock and Roll Religion, as always. And we'll be covering Hellhammer and Celtic Frost.
Nice. Celtic Frost. That could be fun. Joe, my friend.
Hey, man. How you doing, 70s? Thanks for having me, man. Tonight I'll be doing Papa Joe Gamer up way too late, trying to stay up on my night off so I can keep my body clock going right. That's 3 hours of video gaming and a few cocktails and fails. Then Thursdays, always 6:30 Central. Me and my brother get together to Hack the Matrix. It's a talk show about current events and pop culture, everything we all talk about in our corner of the internet. And, of course, every weekend, it's Friday and Saturday, 4 p.m. Central. The guy behind me there, the privateer, you get to see it from the ground up. I think I'll be plotting page 8, and we got a special edition of it Saturday because all the guys that have been trying to get me to do this for about a decade are going to be on there. We're having a League Mythology reunion. And it's going to be a bunch of guys that I played the game DC Universe Online with back in the day when that game first got started. It just turned 11 this year, I think. Yeah. So that's a big one. If you guys can watch, I know my sketching stuff sometimes gets boring, but that's a special one. You guys want to find out about the privateer and what he's all about. There's going to be 6 other guys that know all about him talking about it. So be there Saturday at 4 p.m. Central if you want to see that. But thanks again for having me, man. I'm always up for it, and I'm really looking forward the most to your Towering Inferno one because I love that movie. Don't ask me why.
Thanks, buddy. It's great to have you here. And really, yep. The privateer is looking fantastic. As you know, I'm keen to get a hold of.
I've got it pulled for you already. I want to put some other stuff together. Like, my wife really got this kickstarted, and we're going to get trading cards made for her. She's going to cosplay as the Royal Fox, and she's going to throw out her trading cards at the. They call it their jazz brunch. It's a Mardi Gras ball. Mardi Gras season is a big thing in Louisiana, guys. We find a reason to party about anything. So, yeah. And so I'm going to put some stuff together and send it to you, man. Okay.
She's literally, thanks, buddy. I appreciate that. She's literally a foxy lady then.
Yes, sir. That's why I call her that. That's why I came up with that name for her. She's a royal fox, man.
She's foxy lady. Yeah, and speaking of foxy ladies, it's my beloved Courtney. How are you, lass? Thanks for
being here.
Oh, I
thought you were going to Darius.
Well, he's beloved too, but you know, he's beloved too.
I have my channel, which is the same as my name, it's Courtney's Fellowship of Oddballs. And I'm actually 3 subs away from hitting 400. Hint, hint, wink, wink. So if anyone wants to help me get up there,
subscribe. But
I do a late night stream on Friday nights called Late Night Johns. And it's got just about everything. We have a lot of fun. And then you'll just see me throughout on other channels during the week. But I'm around. So, yeah.
Great. Thanks, Lass. Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
And last and definitely not least is the co-executive assistant production producer and all-round buddy of mine, Darius.
Unlimited power!
You're now the ultimate power in this stream.
It sounded like Emperor Palpatine with Down syndrome.
Hey, what's up, thanks, buddy? Hey, you know, I love your shows. Thanks for allowing me to be a part of it and trusting me with the magic powers. And this is a show I've been waiting for a while because, you know, I'm a big metalhead. And, this is fun. It's a good time. And I'll be doing the Wednesday movie review with Slash from Explitter and Carol's Cookies, and I will announce whenever I do my turn to live stream. I will I'll put the word out about it on Gilded and Twitter and all that.
All right, buddy. Look forward.
In the meantime,
yeah.
You can catch me here and over there,
and somewhere, wherever you are, you will be somewhere. Thanks for joining me. Thanks for helping me out with some of the backstage stuff and for your insight into you've got incredible music taste and experiences. So thanks for providing those to us. Appreciate it, mate. And as for me, as for this show, I have been doing them every 2 weeks recently, but next I'm going to drop that for a while. Next week we will be doing a show. Which will be at the same time on a Monday. What's today? 8th? Monday 15th. 2 p.m. Pacific. We're going to do another show, a special show. This time it's going to be about the California scene, metal and punk and whatever, in fact. So
California, brah.
California, brah.
Righteous, dude.
So we're going to be talking LA, Sunset Strip. We're going to be talking the Bay Area and thrash and speed metal. We're going to be talking punk scene in LA and other places. Everything from the kind of Van Halen era onwards. So metal and punk, etc. That's the focus, California. Obviously LA. There's some stuff in Bakersfield. There's a few bits and pieces there. And this panel, I'm hoping, will all be there, along with some other special guests. I don't want to jinx it, but a special guest who has a substantially large channel that does a lot of stuff on a Friday afternoon has promised to attempt to join that show next week. Anyway, let's all leave it at that. Who could it be? Who could it be? But anyway,
don't say his name. Don't say.
He used to live in California, but so
it'd be totally tubular.
I will provide more information on that closer to the show when it is publicized. So we'll be joined, I'm hoping, by this very special guest who's into music and doesn't get the chance to talk about it as much as he would like. So be there for that. And in 2 weeks' time, the show will be about the movie The Towering Inferno. So we're going back to the movies, get your popcorn. We're going to watch one of the greatest disaster movies ever made. And I'm not talking about The Last Jedi. I'm talking about The Towering Inferno, where we get to burn the building down. It's going to be awesome. Love that movie. And I'm sure we'll have a lot of fun like we did with our other movie streams. So, and I've got a video I'm working on, a review of the Indian epic Bahubali. Working on a review of those movies right now after watching them. My God, they're good.
Bahubali?
Yeah, great movie.
Close, but you're way off.
Close, but way off, yeah. You just offended half of the planet there. But...
Yeah, no, fair.
So,
hey, I got to start somewhere. I'll start with this half, and then I'll get the other one next week.
Yeah.
So thanks again to the chat. Thanks to my panel. And I will play you out with a reprise of the opening montage. So until next time, keep on rocking. Good night, everybody.
Take care, guys. Hail the chat.
And here it goes.